you wanna make love under the stars above.
Context of White Supremacy, Gusty Renegade in for another broadcast, hopefully to share constructive information on the system of white supremacy. Today's day, Thursday, November 4, 2021. So I have been told. This is our fifth and final study session on Ernest Tidyman's Shaft. Now, one of the reasons that I said, oh man, we should read this book. One, I thought most people didn't know it was written by a white person. True. Also, this book is really short. Thus, we are done today. So I felt even if everybody hated it, it's the worst book ever, we'll be done quickly. We can do our assessment of what we've learned over these few short weeks and then move on to a new text. We are picking up on chapter 13, going right to the end. In fact, there's so little of the book left that we'll be done. The second audio segment, they include in the book, a teaser of one of Ernest Tidyman's other books. I told you there's six in this series, I guess you want to say. One of them is Shaft Among the Jews. So we'll be able to hear a little bit of that as we get rolling for today. Again, I say keep in mind, who was this book written for? Do we think a white man in 1968 sat down to write this sort of book for black readers? Even who was the film? Are we sure this project, this film series, was made for black people? Just something to ponder on as we wrap up concluding thoughts, final assessments, Ernest Tidyman's Shaft, audio segment one. The cows.
13. Ben Buford led 15 men to Washington Square. They traveled in three cars and parked them in the underground garage of a luxury apartment on Lower Fifth Avenue, about three blocks north of the beautiful alabaster arch at the entrance to the green. The garage attendant thought of turning them away. He would have if it had been Ben alone. Instead, he gave them tickets to his fear, and the eventual claiming of the cars watched them march out of the garage and then called the police. "There's something funny going on," he said. The announcement did not amuse the police department, but it did not alarm the department at first. Blacks were free to move through the city so long as they remembered the shuffle. Three and four abreast, the revolutionary band marched down the swept, almost polished sidewalks in front of the glistening buildings that form a luxury strip of about three or four blocks below 14th Street. They passed a uniformed officer lolling around the corner of 9th Street and 5th Avenue, and they were noticed by a cruising squad car moving slowly down Fifth Avenue. The officer on the corner went to the nearest pea-green lamppost call box, and the men in the car radioed their headquarters. But neither attempted to interfere with the orderly, quiet movement toward the square. The parks of New York are for everyone, so long as they have the courage to enter them. They were a black blotch, a smear against the towering pink and white columns of exclusive comfort that lined Fifth Avenue in these few blocks. A sooty tar patch on the fresh purity of the early morning. The black men who walk in Greenwich Village are part of the night, when their contrast does not offend the eye so sharply. This was an indignity, an outrage of blackness. These 15 or 16 tall young men in dashikis, turtlenecks, leather jackets, beads, and medallions dangling around their necks. They were made the more ominous, threatening, and collectively black by the discipline of their movement down Fifth Avenue toward the small square park. They walked as a unit and a pack, not a raggle-taggle band, closely and confidently. "All right," Ben Buford said when they were at the northern perimeter of the park. "Start banging on them goddamn doors. Ask the white folks what they're going to do for the black brothers today. Insult the shit out of them. Do it fast. Don't let them close those doors. Drag them out of the steps and yell at them. Two by two, they moved off to the steps of the expensive pampered brownstones in the apartment buildings that encircle the park. Buford jogged up the steps of the nearest, a red brick and iron-trimmed residence of a corporation lawyer named Arthur Kravitz, who was at that moment slipping into a paisley silk robe to descend the stairs for breakfast and a perusal of the Wall Street Journal that the housekeeper would have put beside his coffee cup. He heard the doorbell ring, wondering what it might be at this hour. Then he heard Buford's companion pass a large draining pot from the front steps into the entrance foyer of the house directly through one of the polished bevel-cut glass windows beside the door. Its meaning was made clear to him by a high-pitched derisive cry that echoed through the house and brought the rest of his family to a state of consciousness, if not understanding.
"Wake up, motherfuckers!"
The voice rang in a clarion of terror.
"Your black brother is here for the weekend!"
In the echoes that filtered through the young, hopeful leaves on the maples and shrubs of the park, Buford could hear glass shatter and the rattle scramble of garbage cans and lids scraping across the pavement. He could see in his mind's eye 25 trembling white hands clutched nervously for the telephones to turn the switchboard of the police department into an astronomy lesson of drunken constellations. Soon he would hear the sirens, too. He thought, looking at the black iron fence around the park, both of jail and the son of a bitch who had opened up on him with the machine gun in Detroit. He would be encircled shortly. His own people were making calls from Harlem to every number they knew in the village, and soon the encirclers would be encircled as well, and the mayhem would fill these streets in a great swirling checkerboard mass of black and white. He leaned over to the shattered window and shouted,
"Get your ass down here!"
It was a small price to pay for the whole of Harlem. The broker of the deal wasn't so sure. Shaft thought he would collapse when he got to the third floor of the McDougal Street building. The exertion was forcing him to breathe hard, and breathing was pushing against the bones of his ribs. Each heartbeat was a slam in the side with a 2x4, and he was drenched with sweat. "Man, let me take that can of gas," urged Willie Joe Smith. His plea may have been less generous than anxious. He wondered when the moment would come that the big bandaged man leading him up the brownstone stairs would fall back upon him and grind him into the steep stairway, spilling gasoline over both of them from the 2-gallon can. Shaft insisted with a spit-blurred hiss. As much as the weight of the gas in his aching body, he could feel the concern of the man Persons had sent to drive him. Willie Smith would go anywhere Knox Person sent him. He was about 45, square in form and concepts, and in his lexicon, the places they were intruding belonged to whites, maybe even white folks, but certainly nothing approaching the psychology of whitey. He was only there because he had been told to be there. An instruction that would have taken him to Hell's Front Lawn as cinders for a Sunday picnic if Knox was bringing the chicken. He had driven the big white Oldsmobile as Shaft had directed, leading a second caravan of three cars of those wild-looking young men down the West Side Highway and into Ninth Avenue at the 19th Street exit, then up Bleecker to the point where Shaft signaled a halt, spoke with the leaders of the other groups, and told Willie Joe to proceed on to McDougal Street. "About right here," Shaft told him. They were midway on McDougal between 4th Street and Houston. Parking was tight. "Don't put it by the fire hydrant," Shaft said. "They may need all they got." Willie Joe found a place marked reserved for delivery vehicles. "We deliverin'," Shaft said, and Willie fitted the chrome-studded Olds into the spot. The street was still empty. It was too early for anyone to be up and heading to work from these apartments, the converted brownstones that demanded the highest of rents, and too late for anyone to be getting home. If they did run into anybody, Shaft realized, he would have one hell of a time producing a spontaneous explanation of why he was there, looking as if he belonged on a shelf in Weber's Meat Market with a sign sticking in his left ear calling for 98 cents a pound. But it was the least of his concerns. He limped and wobbled as he walked to the small green stucco foyer of a brownstone that had become an apartment house, with Willie Joe Smith coming up close behind like a child who didn't want to lose track of his mom in a strange and hostile place. "You want me to stay here and watch?" he asked. "Come on," Shaft said brusquely. "You may have to carry me the hell out of here." He did the plastic card case routine with the door lock. "That's no trouble," Willie Joe said. "The only trouble comes now." He went up the stairs noiselessly, slowly. The gas can dragged at his hand like an anchor 5 inches in the mud, and the metal handle worked on a bruise on his hand. Willie Joe was carrying a wad of newspapers and a coil of backyard laundry line rope. The hallways were clean and silent, the steps covered with a tile tread that was either swept or mopped regularly. How simple it was to live cleanly, decently, he thought. "You all right?" Willie Joe asked. Shaft wasn't sure. He seemed to know what he was doing, but he couldn't focus his mind. There was a dream quality about doing this, being here. He felt disembodied, floating from the top of his skull out into some other place and time while his body went through these programmed motions. Where was he going again? Oh, yes. Up to the roof of the building. Up there to burn down Thompson Street. That's right. Keep going. One foot and then another. He could hear a radio playing behind one of the doors on the third floor. Somebody waking up to the urgency of Jim Morrison going on. Come on, baby. Light my fire. Baby coming. Shaft was halfway up the steps on the fourth floor before the ridiculous coincidence struck him. The smile cracked the alum-drawn scab on his lip, and he winced. The song was working his head. Shaft is going to light your fire. Shaft is going to light. Why? Why was he doing this? The pain asked the question. So did his continuing sense of futility that descended upon him in regard to the people involved. Hate, a job of work, a black thing, an evil thing. Revenge? The questions were new to him. He was so fucking tired and lonely, puzzled by the sweeping assault of doubt. He tried to remember, and the simple hurt made it difficult. He could remember the $10,000 in the freezer compartment of his refrigerator. What the fuck good was it? He couldn't buy those last 8 steps with him, or the roof, or a breath that didn't go into him like a blunt spear. What he remembered most, what goaded him, was a barely visible, faintly discernible image of some people who thought he had been slowed to a crawl, who believed they had put him out of action while they tidied up the mess he had made in their well-organized lives and used his bleeding carcass as both the medium and the message of their purpose. He was the errand boy, and what they had done to him was what they had to say. Yes, that was it, he thought. He was here because of that. Within the hour of their relaxation and confidence that he had been dealt with for more than enough hours. He was still John Shaft. That was enough. He had earned the right to believe it. Can you climb that? Willie Joe whispered. Shaft reached up for a rung of the narrow steel ladder rising out of the fourth floor toward the TV antenna jungle of the tar paper roofs. If I can, he said, I'm going to fly. Come right up behind me. If I start to slip, push my ass up through that hole. 12 rungs, one at a time. Each one a little slower, sometimes an arm around the ladder rather than a hand on the rungs, but making it. He pushed the top off the access portal in the roof with his head. He simply couldn't lift his arm with the gas can. He crawled out onto the tar paper and stayed there on his hands and knees, his body begging for repayment of the spent strength. Willie Joe bent over and touched his shoulder. How can I help you? Let me breathe a minute, Shaft gasped. He sucked shallow gulps of air, fighting himself not to take too much. Balancing the desperate need against the crippling pain. He was barely able to raise his head and look around. Rooftops were all alike, Harlem or the village, Beekman Place or Hell's Kitchen. Nobody could see it, so nobody gave a damn what it was like, except where people used them for summer sun and soot baths. These were spring roofs, collections of tar cans as mementos of winter's emergency plugins. Look for boards, he told Willie. Planks, long as you can find, over there. He pointed his head toward the next roof, where some construction seemed to be underway on the housing for an elevator control system or an air conditioning plant. What you want boards for? Willie Joe asked. I can't jump these buildings. We gotta walk across. Hurry. Willie Joe started moving, a big brown chipmunk scurrying across the rooftops, gathering peanuts here, there, and back again. There were boards all over the rooftops. It was a place to store them for the building custodians, whose basements were already cluttered with trash piles. Shaft started to get to his feet, and the .45 fell out of his waistband onto the roof with a heavy thud. Not yet, baby, he said, hoping he wasn't directly above the bedroom of a burglary nervous old maid. He didn't move for a moment and waved Willie Joe to a silent pause in his scavenging. He stooped to pick up the gun, got the gas can, and tiptoed to the rear edge of the roof. The chasm between this McDougal Street building and the one facing Thompson was only 8 feet. He didn't think the opposite number across the small alley was one that he wanted, but he'd have to look down into the street to tell. By then, Buford's men would be on the front of the place. They had the number. Willie Joe had a stack of 10- and 12-foot boards ready for the bridge. Together, Shaft helping as much as he could, they eased them out into the air one by one, touching the opposite parapet and then setting them into place.
These things hold us?
Willie Joe asked.
What else is there?
Shaft grumbled impatiently. He regretted it. What right did he have to put down this man who was helping him? Willie Joe had run his share of tenement rooftops. He was as calm about leaning over the parapet to build their bridge as a window washer dangling on the edge of eternity against the assurance of heavy leather safety straps. There were no straps for Willie Joe, except his toes digging into the center of balance in his shoes. Chef thought he heard noises and the rumbled noises of a mob. So soon, where were the sirens? Or was it the rumble of his own anxiety? It told him to hurry. He looked out at the boards across the space between the buildings and felt his mouth turn dry. "Listen," he said to Willie, "I can't walk that. I'm going across on my hands and knees. If I fall, just get the fuck out of here. There ain't nothing left to do after that." Willie Joe nodded. Chef guessed the man had enough to do with the rope and the papers. The way his head was spinning, the way the twinges kept coming at him from new directions with each movement, he couldn't risk 8 feet without a wobble or a lurch. He got up on the parapet on his hands and knees, careful not to shake the boards loose at either end. The gas. He had to take the gas can. He put it out on the planks in front of him, bent over, and gripped the handle with his teeth. It forced his head straight down. One thing, he couldn't look over the edge of the plank. He didn't need to. He knew what was down there. A few inches at a time, as far as he could move one knee and then the other. One thing about big pain, he thought, gets rid of all the little pains. It also made him want to just stretch out, face down on the boards and forget about it all, high above the alley, let it all go floating by. His ears began to ring with a screaming clangor of pounding blood. If it got any stronger, his head would explode. Inch by inch, keep moving. It got louder. He discovered that it wasn't his head. It was every siren in the city wailing towards Washington Square. There must be one hell of a brawl beginning there. The drop of pleasure falling on a sea of pain stirred laughter in Shaft's depths. He couldn't let it out. He had to grind his teeth on the gas can handle. He had to hurry. The time was now. Andarazzi got the phone on the second ring. "Yes." "It's happening in Washington Square," the commissioner said. "I wondered what all the sirens were about." "The tactical force responded, but it's the goddamnedest riot they've ever seen." "Why?" "There's nobody to fight except white people. There's about 15 or 20 black bastards up in trees throwing pop bottles and insults at a lynch mob of whites from the apartment houses around the square." "What are they doing?" "They're protecting those bastards in the trees by hitting a lot of decent citizens over the head." "Well, that's smart. Hang on." Andarazzi waited while the commissioner got his emergency phone. He used the pause to work his arms into the sleeves of his jacket, hanging on the back of his chair. He was going to be traveling. A shaft in a tree? He hoped so. It sounded like Shaft.
"It's all changed."
The commissioner rattled at him.
"How?"
"Blacks from all over the village pouring into the square behind the whites, trapping them between the police. It's a hell of a brawl now."
"Who's in the trees?"
"We'll wish we were when the mayor hears about it. I'm going down there. I'll pick you up on the way."
Shaft peered over the edge of the far parapet into Thompson Street. They were standing to either side of a building 3 doors down.
That was the one.
He moved toward it, over the cindered asphalt of the roof and cautiously lifting a leg over the barriers he would have leaped as a youth, hurrying as much as he could. When he reached the building he wanted, Chef took the newspapers from Willie Joe. He crumpled the sheets into a huge ball around 3 twisted paper logs and tied it all together with the rope. He lowered it quickly over the edge until it dangled like a newsprint moon outside a shade-covered window on the 3rd floor. There was a brick lying in the asphalt beside the ledge. Shaft used it as a counterweight to secure the end of the rope, then began to work with the gasoline. "Willie Joe," he said, dripping gas onto the taut line, watching it run down and soak into the paper as quickly as he poured it. "I'm going down into the building." The fumes of the gasoline worked through the mushy cartilage of his nose. He liked the smell.
"I'll go with you, man," Willie Joe said. "You ain't in no shape to go alone."
"Shut up and listen. You're going to hear some shooting. As soon as you do, light a match to this rope. You got a match?"
Willie Joe fumbled in his pockets. He came up with matches.
"Just put a match to it and get the hell out of here as fast as you can go. Back the same way. Anybody bothers you, tell them you made a delivery. You got it straight, man?"
"I got it."
"See you later, Willie Joe."
He kicked the lid off the rooftop hatch simply because it was easier than bending over. He peered down. Same sort of ladder, but it would be easier going down. The gas can was more than half empty. The gallon's weight made a lot of difference. would make a hell of a torch outside the window, too. He glanced at Willie Joe standing next to the rope as he was letting himself down the hatch, feeling for the rungs with his feet. He wanted to wink at the man. His eyes were so swollen he couldn't. Shaft was at the bottom of the ladder in a minute or so. Even there in the dark hallway, he could hear the sirens raging outside. Ben Buford, just hang in there, he thought. Just hang in there long enough to let 10 black men loiter in front of the building on Thompson Street because there ain't nobody nowhere who wasn't busy right now. Nobody who could ask them questions, make them move along. At the stairwell, Shaft peered down the narrow slot of the zigzag descent. He could see all the way to the first floor. He tipped the gas can and let the rest of it slosh into the emptiness, dripping and splashing on each set of stairs as it fell, filling the building with the raw, unmistakable fumes of disaster. An hour ago, they kicked him down those stairs like a bag of empty beer cans. He threw the can down the crevice and listened to it rattle and echo emptily to the bottom. He got the .45 out of his belt, found an extra clip in the pocket of the jacket.
Fire!
He bellowed as loudly as short breath would permit.
The goddamn building is on fire! Fire!
He pointed the black cannon to the roof and squeezed. The explosion shook a shower of dust and plaster down around him.
Fire! Bang, bang, bang.
Three more into the roof.
Fire, we're trapped! Bang, bang, bang.
That was seven. Still one in the chamber. He flicked the catch on the empty cartridge clip and let it fall to the floor as he slammed the fresh one into the handle.
Bang, bang, bang.
It felt good. It was the 4th of July, Halloween, and the Alamo all at once. He found breath in the exhilaration, ignored the pain, and let out a hideous, grating scream.
I'm burning to death! Fire! Bang, bang, bang.
6 from 8 cartridges left 2 in the clip, 1 in the chamber. He dug for the second spare clip as he let the 3 rip into the roof. He had killed Charles Caroli in the hallway of this building. There wasn't a goddamn peep out of anybody. Now the rat's nest was coming alive. Shouts, screams, and shrieks echoed from the apartments along the hallways. Doors flew open.
Gas!
A man's voice cried out.
The building's full of gas!
Fire! Shaft shouted.
Niggers! The niggers are coming!
A woman screamed. More doors slammed open. He could hear people running, stumbling, falling. He screamed again. It was beautiful. He was imitating the victim in a gray B horror movie. He changed clips in the gun, jacked a bullet into the chamber. That was all he had. He started for the dark stairs, listening to the churning mass of confusion he had caused, listening for the voices of the ones he wanted. Slowly, easily, Shaft leaned against the wall and went down the stairs sideways, left foot down first. A door flew open above him, and he spun to face a woman in a nightgown and a man in his shorts. She screamed. The man looked stunned.
Right this way, police department. Keep calm, right this way.
They plunged toward the bedlam. They were the bedlam. He waved them on with the .45. They fell past him in a blind panic, hysteria. When they were 2 flights below him, part of a fighting, struggling mass to get out of the building, he fired 2 more shots into the air. He could pick the woman's scream out of 8 or 10 that responded. She was a great screamer. This was the hallway. The last of Charles Caroli had been wiped from the wall. The door was open, its new brass lock glittering innocently. He looked in, knowing it would be empty. The bed was bare. There was nothing. Cigarette smoke curled up from an ashtray on the dresser. A great red ball of flame hung outside the window. The heat of an inferno curled the shade and pushed against his face. Shaft turned to move down the next flight. It was roaring madness below him. He had never heard so many obscenities, even in the pain of war. What would happen in a real fire? He kept going against the wall, slowly, carefully, the gun high, ready. In a second now. He heard the feet coming up the stairs as fast as feet can go. Then the face appeared. Shaft remembered it well. He always would. The face was shocked, incredulous, so disbelieving that it ran right to the muzzle of the .45 before Shaft squeezed the trigger and blew it off. He stepped over the body and kept moving. On the second floor landing, he found Beatrice. She was out, and there was nothing to cover her. A beige doll tossed into the corner. He wasn't even sure she was alive. The one up there, the one without a face, had probably been carrying her down behind the others. Where were they? Shaft stooped and put his left arm under the girl's right arm and shoulder. Her head fell back loosely, her mouth open. His right arm went under her knees, the gun still out front. He expected to die trying to lift her. She was remarkably light. He held her in his arms for a minute and turned to the last of the steps. He staggered on the twinge of a failing tendon in his left knee, then straightened. This he had to do. This he had to make. The whole fucking building would go up any second in the raw stink of gasoline. Shaft heard a shot from the streets, then two quick ones in response. He went down the stairs like a zombie, carrying the bride of Frankenstein. He was saying something, sobbing and blinking his eyes to keep them clear. He couldn't hear himself above the shouting from the street as he approached the doorway. But the muffled chant was part of the chorus of frenzy. Kill the cocksuckers! Kill them! Kill them! Kill them! He couldn't stop at the doorway. One lead leg after the other, he staggered out onto the top step of the building. There was a small mob in the street. He could make out black faces, dancing up and down, white people in their underwear, fists flying. There was a body in the street. No, two. He looked up Thompson and saw a car moving through the mass, pushing people aside with its fenders and bumpers. A fat man in a bathrobe couldn't get out of the way in time. The car went over his leg, and he screamed, then rolled into the mass around him. Bless your black ass, Willie Joe, Shaft said, or maybe thought. He was never quite sure, because at the moment of the words, he fainted. 14. Where are you going? Silence. John? Huh? I asked where you were going. Oh. Shaft sat in the middle of the living room floor, legs folded under each other in an Indian squat. I don't know, he said. Away. He studied the bi-level plastic device on the floor carefully. The kid had beaten him 4 games out of 5 in 3-dimensional tic-tac-toe, and he had actually been trying. It was embarrassing. Helen Green gazed affectionately at the hulk of him against the beige carpet with her son, the two of them concentrating fiercely. Her son's hand moved quickly to the game.
I win,
he shrieked. Damn, Shaft said.
I win, I win, I win, I win. You're lousy.
The little bastard didn't have to be so cocky about it. I never saw this game before tonight, Shaft defended himself. You had practice. That's enough, Ellen said. Pick that up and take it to your room.
I want to beat him again, the boy protested.
Maybe he doesn't want to be beat again, she said. Shaft was stung twice. Mind your mama, he said. I'll get you next time.
No, you won't, no, you won't, no, you won't, no, you won't, no, you won't,
the boy chanted.
I win, I win, I win.
He grabbed up the plastic shelves of the game and scooted out of the living room, chanting all the way. Shaft reached out and swatted him on the tail as he went past. Then he continued to stare at the rug where the game had been played and lost. Next time. He'd get it next time because his mind would work on it. He'd beat the kid. Then he'd have to start throwing the game so he wouldn't feel bad.
How long will you be gone?
Huh?
You aren't hearing me, she said.
Yeah, well, he sighed. Getting up off the floor, still favoring the right leg a little where the ligament had been torn and was still mending under heavy strapping. Yeah. Shaft walked over to the heavy crystal decanters that Marvin Green found in those good little Second Avenue antique shops like Eris on his lunch hour, haggling with some nice young man with a funny mustache. What was his name? Harris. Harris something. What's the name of that antique dealer where Marvin gets these things?
Harris Diamond, she said. A shop called Eris.
I know that. Just couldn't remember the man's name. Nice man.
Yes,
she said, watching the glass in Shaft's hand glow amber as he poured almost 2 inches of scotch into it.
How'd it go today?
He was sipping the scotch straight, without ice. He wasn't hearing anything she said. He took a long pull at the whiskey and looked at the glass, frowned at it. How long did Marvin say he would be? He asked, as if her husband were lurking somewhere at the bottom of the liquid in the tumbler.
An hour or so.
He said a client was being audited and then panicked. He had to get it straight for the Internal Revenue people.
Yeah, well.
He drank some more.
John, she insisted, listen to me a minute.
He turned his face to hers, if not his attention. There were new scars, still red and angry scars, as companions for the saddle stitching of the bicycle chain.
What went on with the grand jury today?
He snorted. Not much, he said. They decided I wasn't a murderer. They come out with something they call a no-bill. Prosecutor chewed on me hard. He paused to think of the district attorney's anger. But what the hell? I've been chewed on before. Will be again. Just reminded me what the rules are about being a detective. Said I violated about 177 laws.
What laws?
Well, there's a lot of gun laws, for one thing. Then there's some shooting laws. Then there's some killing laws.
some setting fire laws, all kinds of laws. They figured out it'd be about 177 laws I broke, technically.
Are you in trouble?
No. He drank deeply again, reached back for the decanter. I had some help.
Who?
Police commissioner, for one. He thought about the short, bald, and direct little man who had the balls to tell a grand jury that the four men who died on Thompson Street were the worst, the very worst of men. Police records down to the floor. Killers, every one of them. Kidnappers. Drug peddlers. Gangsters in the act of holding a 19-year-old girl for extortion, feeding her heroin. They happened to die while a licensed agent was performing a service for a client. They were very violent men. Violence surrounded them. They attracted it and lived by it. This time, they did not survive it. He went on to say that they had previously killed the five Negroes in the Amsterdam Avenue shooting. But he did not say that the dying may have prevented the deaths of hundreds. Nor did he say anything at all to Shaft. He glared at him as he entered the grand jury room, and glared at him as he left. Only later did Shaft learn what he had done in the rarest of appearances by a commissioner before a grand jury in payment for the tanks that would not roll in the streets. Him and some others, Shaft said. Listen, there's no point in me hanging around. I think I'll get down to my pad and get some things done.
But Marvin wants to see you.
Yeah, well, he sipped the scotch. I got to get out of here before I drink all this whiskey. Listen, that brown envelope there, it's got like $15,000 cash in it.
What?
So I wouldn't let the kids play with it. It's a fee. But you tell Marvin that nobody's going to report it being paid to me. He needs to do what he thinks best about the taxes and things and putting it in the bank. I mean, he wants to just salt it away somewhere. That's all right. Tell him the fee was... Never mind. I'll tell him sometime. Shaft had nearly $5,000 more in his pocket. He put the glass down on the ladies' home journal to protect the veneer of the coffee table. Listen, I'll be in touch, he said, limping toward the closet, finding his belted brown raincoat and plunging his arms into it impatiently. She followed him to the door, reaching up to fix the collar.
Why don't you wait and tell him?
She persisted. That's all right, he said. I'll give him a call. He had to get the hell out of there. His nerves were as ragged as the old gray suit he pushed down the incinerator that morning. If anybody could look at nerves, they'd probably see old gray suit threads torn at the shoulder, coffee and water-stained, rumpled and weary and worn. He couldn't stand women fussing with his clothes. Her hand at his collar made him twitch. Yeah, he said. I'll give him a call when I get back. Week or so. Bye. He leaned over to let her kiss him on the cheek. She held the lapel of his raincoat for a moment, then moved her hand to his arm.
John, she said, please take care of yourself.
Yeah, he said automatically, not caring, feeling so sad about not caring and wondering why he did not feel and why he was sad. Well, he turned and limped down the hallway, found the elevator mercifully waiting at the floor when he pushed the button. He looked back. Helen Green was standing at the door. He waved a little flip of fingers and got in. Some others had spoken for him. Knox Parson's for another. He had put the whole of Harlem Rackets on the line for the grand jury. That and the story of Beatrice and how she was in a place called Gracie Square Hospital, getting off the horse, getting her head turned around. Knox didn't tell them about Ben Buford, that this was the price he paid to get her there. He just told them enough about what he had done for a living and what Shaft did for him. Enough. And some others spoke. Shaft shrugged deeper into the raincoat and felt cold, even in a spring afternoon that was making promises about summer. Cold, lifeless, drained. The motherfuckers had taken it out of him. He had to get it back.
Hey, John,
the voice called from the Plymouth sedan.
Oh, shit. Couldn't he go anywhere, do anything without this?
Want a ride downtown? Andarazzi asked from the front seat window of the unmarked police car. Shaft walked up to the side of the vehicle.
No, he said. I'm going to get a cab.
Give you a ride to a cab stand?
No, Shaft said.
You all right?
Getting there.
It was a rough one. Shaft bent over with a twinge in his chest to see who was driving. Nobody he knew.
It was rough, he agreed.
Okay, John, Andarazzi said.
Here.
The hawk-faced lieutenant handed a brown paper bag out the window of the car. Shaft took it. The package was heavy. He opened it and looked inside. It was the .38 from the hook under the no-name bar, the gun that had taken out Charles Caroli.
Put that back where it belongs, he said.
Will there be a kick later?
No. No kicks later. It's all taken care of.
You sure you don't want to ride?
No, Shaft said. One thing.
Yes.
When the fuck can I start moving around without being followed?
Right now, Andreazzi said with a wave. The car moved away from the curb. See us.
Not if I see you first, he said to the departing license plate.
He turned to hunt down a cab. Done, done, done. It was over. Knox was paying the dues. Buford was collecting them. The silly son of a bitch would think he cleaned up Harlem after a while. Maybe he had. There were some cars, none of them cabs. Buford wouldn't know what to do with a clean Harlem now that he had it, making speeches to retired pushers. Shit. There was a cab with its dome light on. Shaft waved. It wasn't going to stop. He stepped off the curb and walked directly into the path of the car and stood facing it with his hands on his hips. He watched the dome light switch to the off-duty signal, but he stood there, and the driver climbed on the brake and stopped, a goggle-eyed driver poking his head out the window.
Off-duty, he said.
Police business, Shaft responded, reaching for his wallet and his identity card.
Oh, the driver said. Okay.
He reached behind him and unlocked the door. Shaft got in, putting the wallet back without showing the driver anything. To hell with him.
Where to, mister?
Kennedy.
The airport?
Yes.
Christ,
the driver protested, setting the car in motion. Shaft folded his arms across his chest and wriggled back into the corner of the cab. He would go to sleep. When he got to the airport, he would buy a ticket. The first name that came to his head, San Francisco, Paris, Tokyo. The first name that came out, he'd go there. He'd get out of this city, out of these people, out of his own skin someplace. Stockholm, he thought. Rio de Janeiro. He played with names and continents. Nobody would know him. Nobody would want him. He would lose himself. He would let the smell of death wash away with each mile, each strange place, each new person he encountered. He wouldn't even give them his right name. They wouldn't know who he was or what he was. And that would make them even.
Context of white supremacy. So technically, we are all done. We could do our hit it and quit it and call it a program, catch everybody tomorrow if we do our little chat it up and all that. However, they include a teaser, that's what I'm calling it, for Ernest Tidyman's other book in the series, Shaft, Among the Jews. So I guess he didn't get a flight to San Francisco or Stockholm, Rio de Janeiro. I don't know where he was going, but apparently we had to keep the series going to hear about his continued beef with so-called Jews. So we'll hear the teaser and that will wrap us up. But before that, we'll get our thoughts, since the book technically is done. We finished Shaft, and we'll get our thoughts on what we heard today. Assessments from the text, who we think this book was written for, major themes other than the homoeroticism and anti-sex that is piled on every page of this book. We'll get our last thoughts of what have you, hear a little tease, I guess it's like a chapter or two, for Shaft Among the Jews, and then we'll wrap up. The number to dial, 720-716-7300. The code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. The number again, 720-716-7300. The code 564-943-pound. Press *61. If you would like to participate, the email untiljustice@gmail.com. Untiljustice@gmail.com. Feel free to drop a line. Any thoughts, questions, observations, we'll get those in as we wrap the book up today. Let's see. I'll start. One of our investors emailed in. Greetings, Gus. Chapter 13. Number one, Ben Buford said, start banging that start banging them goddamn doors. Ask the white folks what they're going to do for their black brothers. Blacks from all over the village pouring into the square behind whites, trapping them behind the police. It's a hell of a brawl now. The whole riot scene seemed unrealistic to me. Many people said that about the movie / the book. Now, this riot scene is not in the movie. This whole scene, maybe, I don't know if Gordon Parks and the other screenplay writer, I don't know if they looked at this and said the same thing. This is unrealistic, but yeah, this is not the way the book wraps up. They do go set out their plan to attack with the gangsters who have stolen the black female, to go attack them, and they have fire and all the rest of it, and they're going to go shoot them up, but it is not, a part of this is not some riot to distract enforcement officials and get them over here and all that, like that. Yeah, I totally agree. And even for that time period, that you would have some black people up in trees with bottles and rocks, and they're chanting, yelling at these white people down below. From what I know, and particularly of that time period, you even heard Mr. Fuller. He's on the program back 2011. He said that at the same time period, the year that Martin Luther King was killed, he said that in D.C., white people that he worked with told him, "We wish you all would have tried something." In fact, Mr. Fuller said that it wasn't the black people that were in the trees. It was the white people who were in trees. They didn't have pop bottles. They had something else that goes pop. Firearms. Wishing. He said that's the language that they used. "We wish you niggers would have come over here, tried to act a fool or what have you. Got my brand new sniper scope. I cannot wait to put a few bullets into a negro or three." That seems more realistic. And then enforcement officials coming in to add to it, or even, hey, they're in a tree, cut the tree down, set the tree on fire, either or. Like, I totally agree. I don't think a scene like that could have played out. And you have the black people in the trees, the white people come, and then another group of black people come behind. They've got, let's see. Chapter 14. I win. The little bastard didn't have to be so cocky about it. Interesting that the white author referred to the black child as a bastard. Important indeed, because apparently he's in, not in a broken family, as they say. He's got his mom present and Marvin, his dad, even though we don't, you know, have contact. So he's got a full family. So why would he be called a little bastard and then a cocky little bastard? See how many of those phallic references just keep coming back up, keep coming back up. White genetic annihilation. Even a child is cocky now. In my view, there have been so many references to Shaft and his penis throughout the text. And then even a child is just thought of as another phallic symbol. So anywho, I'll read the last portion once we finish the text. Let's see. Folks who dialed in, as I said, hey, any of the folks who said I didn't like this book, it's not fun or whatever, we are done. No, even you don't even have enough time to gripe and be disgruntled about the book not being cool. Let's see. *61 for folks who have any thoughts, concluding analyses of the text. Let's see. Let's see. Folks are spectating or getting their thoughts together. I'll share some of my thoughts from the first portion, technically the end of Shaft, and then see if folks have any other thoughts to share. If not, we'll get to the second audio. That is the teaser for Shaft Among the Jews, and we'll be all done. Let's see. So, thoughts. Let's see. Oh, that's the wrong book. Had too many books pulled up. Reading is more important than watching television. All right, let's try it again with the correct book. All right, chapter 13. So we pick up, they have already checked in with Knox Parsons, and they've kind of got their plan together, Ben Buford and Shab, Ben Buford's other black people in his organization. We're going to go get Beatrice back, Knox Parsons' daughter. We'll go get her back. So describe the initial part of their plan. They're organizing their first group of them. They're going over. They're going to get in the tree. They cause this big disruption, doing all this yelling, and your black brothers are out here. You all are going to pay, blah, blah, blah. That seems kind of goofy, too. But he says, so Ben and his group, they go at the beginning part of all this, and it says they were a black blotch, a smear against the towering pink and white columns of exclusive comfort that line Fifth Avenue in these few blocks, a sooty tar patch on the fresh purity of the early morning. Now, I think, you know, that's pretty, both of those metaphors, they're a black blotch and then a sooty tar patch. Both of those, just like, and a sooty tar patch, that's contrasted to the purity of the early morning. Now just ponder about that in terms of the anti-blackness. That's why I said again the whole time, like a white person writing this book, these sort of metaphors and what have you, if I'm Richard Roundtree, if I read the book, man, I'd have to have a serious conversation. Like, I don't know if he knew about Dr. Welsing at the time. The ISIS papers wasn't written, but I mean, woof, it would be some serious, like, yeah, I'm not a big actor and I want my breakout role and all that stuff, but wow. Like, it would be lots of things. All the homoerotic, it would be lots of reasons to think, like, man, is this the role that I want? Maybe I can wait around a little bit and see if, you know, Melvin Van Peebles is going to do something else, or I don't know. I can wait around for a better project, but I don't know if this Shaft thing. Let's see. Continuing. Your black brother. I got such a kick out of that. They have brother used in here a few times, but your black brother is here for the weekend. Let's see. Now Ernest Tidyman has one character in the book who's named Willie Smith, not to be confused with the great Will Smith, who's in King Richard right now. I can't wait to see that. So he says Willie Smith would go anywhere Knox Parsons sent him. He was about 45, square in form and concepts, and in his lexicon, the places they were intruding belonged to whites, maybe even white folks, but certainly nothing approaching the psychology of whitey. Now, I don't know what that means at all. That's another point. There are many points in this book where it's just like, wow, so we have a white author writing this about black people and the thought process of black people, and he has black people calling other black people Uncle Toms and you're not black enough. Just like, one, white people are not ignorant about racism. Two, like, that's what I mean. Like, so who was this book written for? I don't even know what this means, that they're intruding into this white residential area where he says, that this area belonged to whites, maybe even white folks. Now, Dr. Maya Angelou used to use that phrase, white folks. They didn't call whites people. She said that specifically in her autobiography, that they was just white folks. And I think there was no space between, it was just one word, white folks. So he says this was the property, this belonged to whites, maybe even white folks, but certainly nothing approaching the psychology of whitey. Again, I have no idea what that means. I know whitey was a popular phrase used at the time, down with whitey and all the rest of it. So I don't know if he's making a distinction. Maybe it almost seems like it could be the psychology of what? The psychology of a racist? As though you have some white people who don't have this racist mentality. I don't know. I'm just fishing here, but that's one of those, like, I don't even know what you're talking about, Ernest Tidyman. Break this down for me. Let's see. Moving a little further, he says, so he has all this Shaft and Willie Smith. They're crawl up to the rooftop and are doing all this elaborate to sabotage the building, setting on fire, spilling gas all over the place. And he says, Shaft realized he would have one hell of a time producing a spontaneous explanation of why he was there, looking as if he belonged on a shelf in a Weber's meat market with a sign sticking in his left ear calling for 98 cents a pound, but it was the least of his concerns. Now, for me, again, so many of the metaphors here, interesting. I've never seen a person who looks like a pound of ground beef. I've never seen that. I've never seen someone who looks like some chopped sirloin or black Angus. All of that to me is just delectable Negro, not just describing a black person as food, but as some sort, something that you would find in a meat market. This black male, now he can say this is because he's all injured and beat up and he's been bloodied and everything, I guess. But, very curious way of phrasing it, that he looks like something that you would pick up and take home for dinner. Let's see. He continues, so Shaft, he's thinking as he's going through all this and they're trying to sabotage this building. Why was he doing this? The pain asked the question. So did his continuing sense of futility that descended upon him in regard to the people involved. Hate? A job of work? A black thing? An evil thing? Revenge? And that's all ended with a question mark. Now, again, a white person writing this, so a Shaft doing this, some of this even seems like it's speaking beyond the book, like he might be commenting about black people, period, at this time period, late 60s, 1970s. Why are the Negroes doing this? Is this a black thing, whatever that means? Is this an evil thing? Is this a revenge thing? Why are they doing this? Black power and down with whitey. Again, people were asking, who is Ben Buford, who is, you know, this a caricature of? And I said it could be anybody. You had so many groups at that time period. It could be the Black Panther Party, or this is on the East Coast. I'm not sure if MOVE was involved at this point, but the Revolutionary Action Movement, RAM, SNCC, there's so many different organizations. They even had some overtones of SNCC a little bit, since some of those members ended up joining the Black Panther Party. It really sounds like it could be, in my view, it could be any black person who at that time, 60s, 70s, is trying to work against racism, white supremacy, and you are thought of in this manner. You know, you're just out doing some sort of evil thing, or your vengeance against whitey thing, or you don't even know what you're doing. Just some crazy, angry black person going to yell in trees and throw pop bottles. Let's see. The metaphors, I picked out so many metaphors in this text. Later on, so Willie Joe Smith, he and Shaft have been doing all this scurrying around, building top right, get these boards together so we can get this fire set up. Tidyman says Willie Joe started moving a big brown chipmunk, scurrying across the rooftops, gathering peanuts here, there, and then back again. Now, I said throughout the text, there's so many times where he has black people who are compared to animals. He has a bunch of these type of metaphors with Ben Buford, comparing him to a grasshopper or some sort of insect, or what have you, a non-person. And then we have the same thing again with Willie Smith, one of Ben Buford's, what you call associates in this organization. Same thing, not a person, some sort of rodent, vermin, some critter. That's what you remind me of. Seems consistent throughout the book in the way that the black people are talked about and presented, what they're compared to. Let's see. All right, so the first part of this, to kind of distract the police and get all this going on while Shaft and the other black people are going to get Beatrice back. So the police commissioner and Andarazi, they hear like, oh my God, there's a riot up in the village and they've got the niggers in the trees and what are we going to do? And so Andarazi is hearing all this. He's talking to the commissioner, like, oh, okay, we'll come pick you up. We'll figure it out, blah, blah, blah. And he says he used the pause to work his arms into the sleeves of his jacket, hanging on the back of his chair. He was going to be traveling. Was Shaft in a tree? He hoped so. It sounded like Shaft. Now, just that part of it, to me, sounded very evocative of lynching. Now, he's already explained these black people are here. They've climbed the tree. They're throwing their pop bottles, yelling at the black people. the long history of lynchings in white culture, and, oh, niggas got on a nerve, put that nigga from a tree, hang that nigga in a tree. It had that feel to it. Now, it could be, hey, Andarazi said, hey, it sounds like this sort of rowdiness, Shaft could be involved. I don't know why you would think that, because he said before that Shaft was not into all this black thing. He wasn't a part of Ben Buford's group. They label him a sellout, an Uncle Tom. Remember that? So I don't know why Andarazi would think, oh, yeah, this sounds like something Shaft would be doing, like, help out your black brother Shaft, and, you know, come on out here. What, like, I don't, that doesn't even make sense based on what we've read in the book, but whatever. Let's see. So then we have Beatrice. That was one thing that I said pay attention to, because the way that Beatrice is written about is very different than the way that the black female who's kidnapped in the movie Shaft. Again, she doesn't have any speaking lines. You don't really hear her. So her part is very small in comparison to the book, where it's regularly writing about her as a heroin user and a drunkard and party girl and all these abortions and all the rest of it. All of that stuff is just not in the movie. And again, in my view, reflects to some degree some anti-blackness. Okay, so we'll put this black female in, but we'll just, you know, have her just be all, to use the metaphor, soiled. She'll be a tarnished character. She's a drug addict, no count, just like the rest of Knox Parsons and these other black hoodlums. So he says, he stepped over the body and kept moving. This is Shaft. On the second floor landing, he found Beatrice. She was out, and there was nothing to cover her. A beige doll tossed into the corner. He wasn't even sure she was alive. The one up there, the one without a face, had probably been carrying her down behind the others. Where were they? And she's just discarded, again, a non-person. And then he comes down. This is just like a paragraph or so below what I just read. He says, Shaft heard a shot from the streets, then two quick ones in response. He went down the stairs like a zombie, carrying the bride of Frankenstein. What Mr. Fuller say? Monsters and monstrosities. Now, we've had many programs we've talked about consistently in literature and film, television, black people equated to zombies. Again, non-persons. Not man, not woman, not child, not even. So that's a huge one. Anytime I see that in literature or what have you, where a black person, and this is Shaft, this is the hero, the main character, is compared to a zombie. Now, again, in the movie, he does get beaten up in everything that we read about last week, but he's not so in pain and out of it that he's like some zombie when all this scene happens. In fact, in the movie, this main scene, he's swinging from ropes from building tops and crashing through windows and all the rest. He's not moving around like some zombie, much less a zombie carrying the bride of Frankenstein. Another ghoul, another monster. It's Halloween time, right? People dress up as Frankenstein. It can't be a black female who's a victim, who's been drugged, may have been killed. Nah. Just got another ghoul. One of the words of the book, cocksuckers, used again. Now, that's at least three times that the word cocksucker has been used in this book. Either called somebody calling Shaft a cocksucker, or Shaft calling somebody else a cocksucker, all that homoerotic verbiage. Just put that on the side. That is a major part of white culture. Another reason why I said I think this might be written for white people, meant for white people to fantasize about all this homoerotic activity, for white men in particular to fantasize about all this homoerotic activity, black male having sex with a white man, and even fantasizing about a black male having sex with a white woman, which is included in the book. Remember, that's at the bar scene, the no-name bar scene that he wrote about. Let's see. Last one from chapter 13. Shaft, he's talking to Willie Joe as they're preparing to get out of there with Beatrice. He says, bless your black ass, Willie Joe. Now, again, when I spoke with Mr. Fuller, he said, man, I didn't know the Shaft was written by a white man, but I'm not surprised if it's got all this homoeroticism and everything is going back to a black male's genitals and having sex with a white person and cocksucker this and all the rest. He said, I'm not surprised. He said, hey, I've been, you know, saying for decades now that all of this is to effeminize the black male, degenderize black people in general, and to have black people chasing the anus of a white man. He said, I've been saying that for years. That's the goal of it. If you're confused about what to do with your genitals,
No universal man, no universal woman for you. You don't even know the basics here. And then, bless your black ass, Willie. Do black people even talk like that? I don't say that to people. Bless your black behind. I don't say that to people. I don't think black people talked this way 50 years ago either, but I could be wrong. Anywho, those are just my notes on chapter 13. I'll pause. Let's see. Retired firefighter in Florida. See your hand. I'll grab other folks as I see them. Any thoughts? In fact, before I even get to that, do you remember, as someone who told us before, I think you were 14 when this movie came out and went to see it and all that, had to get your, they had all that rubbish about make sure your parents have said that you can go, can't go see Shaft. It's got all this, you know, filthy foulness in it. Do you remember if black people talked that way in the 1970s? Like, bless your black ass. Do you remember that being something people said?
No, that definitely wasn't the slang, the quote unquote hip slang, up to date stuff that was being said by younger non-white black people at all. That was not basically what the science that I make out of that is. White people, they definitely hear us and hear what we're saying. And they'll put words together, those slang terms together, in the way that they want them to, the way they want to use them. And however they construct them, they will construct them to their best interest. That is paramount with the global system of racism and white supremacy. If they're going to use anything that we start, it's going to be to their best interest. And that quirky, like, backwards like use of those slang terms is typical of white people, if you ask me. It's typical of white people on how they use it. And when we would hear it, it's almost meant to be a joke in a lot of cases. Richard Pryor was good at using the voices of white people attempting to sound black. He was very good at that as a comedian, into doing that in a lot of his skits. As you know, his skits were like real life type of skits that he would talk about, and that was the basis of his comedy. And so that's something that white people put together. The words may not be theirs. It may be the slang terms, but how it's put together is definitely, you could tell just by that phrase that you mentioned, that's definitely was something that comes from a white person or a culture that does. At all. But anyway, I was going to answer some of those other questions that you were asking. No, the book definitely was not made for black people at all. Matter of fact, the phrase, if you want to hide something from black people, you put it in the cover of a book, was very popular during that time. So I would say collectively, it gives an understanding. I'm not saying 100% that it was true, but I would basically lean more in that direction, that we weren't doing a whole lot of reading. There were some people who did reading during that time, a significant number of non-white people who were classified as black, but not a whole lot of us. But the book definitely was not made for black people. I didn't hear nothing about it until you brought it up and decided to read this book, you know, and I knew all about all of those different movies on Shaft, although the only one that was interesting to me, especially at that particular point in time, 1971, was the one that we're talking about now. The rest of them was just like most movies. When you put different parts to a movie, they're almost never as good as the first one, except for the Godfather movies. I would say that's an example of that's different from from that. But the movie was made for black people. I think Mr. Parks and probably some other black people, because they were allowed to have their insight and understandings. Of course, they're going to take it along with them as they're directing the movie, and they made the movie as best as they could, I would say, under the restrictions that probably more than likely was put on them to basically attract black people. And at that time, 1971, you're talking about Malcolm X killed 65, Dr. King killed a few years, 3 years after 65, 68. By that time, the Black Panther Party, the membership was on the run. They were trying to either get out the country or quote unquote go underground. 1971, the Black Panther Party was destroyed as a functional organization by that time. And so it would have been reasonably perfect for if you are a person with movies and whatnot to put some kind of fantasized situation where a black male and some other black males organize together a means to get at a white people, the man, or white people and whatnot, whether it's criminal or not, and come out on the end successful. And the star of the movie lives. The black male star of the movie lives, which, of course, they got it from Sweetback, the Sweetback movie. That's, you know, it basically had that in the end with him running away with music from Earth, Wind, and Fire being played, you know, in that movie. And so basically it's almost the same thing. It was some kind of song, I would believe, that was being played at the end of the movie. The movie was made for black people, I would say. Anywhere from teenagers up until probably the black person in their 40s. I would say it was made for that because it certainly was very popular with black people. I would say it was very popular, probably the most popular movie for black people to attend to in 1971. Yeah. Well, one of the top. I don't know if it is the top, but one of the top movies in 1971. Yeah. Hopefully I answer your question.
Much obliged. Retired firefighter in Florida. Now, there were limited releases throughout the early part of the summer, meaning like June 1971, but the major release where it was, you know, widespread amongst theaters was 4th of July weekend of 1971. So intended for a large swath of people. And importantly, as he had mentioned, Sweet Sweetback's bad song, Melvin Van Peebles, just passed away a few weeks ago, 2021. And his movie, Sweetback, came out literally months before Shaft was released in the spring of 1971, as you said. And in that movie, the main character does live, and they've got the Earth, Wind, and Fire plan in the background and all of that. So, and that was a film that the Black Panther Party did endorse and made members go watch. So I'm pretty sure the white folks at MGM and all the rest were looking at that saying, ooh, we are about to make a killing, literally, on the financial side with this movie, which they did. And confusion. Like, oh yeah, I'm not saying Sweetback is super constructive either, but ooh, it does not have all that homoeroticism in it, unless I'm confused, and all the rest of it. Like, ooh, we are gonna win this one all the way through. Lots to process on that. I'll get in my last little quick comment on chapter 14, just in terms of the unbelievability of all of this. I read the review from the New York Times last week where they said the exact same thing, that this movie is so unbelievable and it just gets more unbelievable as it goes on. The same thing with the book. Now, you're going to tell me what we heard And like I said, it's not quite the same in the movie. Like, the whole riot thing isn't there, but the rest of it, like them going and setting fire and killing all these white people and all that stuff is in the movie. So you're going to tell me that a black person who is not a police officer, and then these in conjunction with these Negro hoodlums, whether they're revolutionaries or whatever, Ben Buford and his outfit, they can go. They're firing guns out in the street, setting fire to property, causing other deaths, and what have you. They can do all of this, and nobody black goes to jail. In fact, because the part that we read this week isn't even in the movie, where they have some sort of hearing, and we even forgot the black guy that went out of the window. There's not even a trial about that. Black Lives Matter, they don't even have a trial about that. Like, that alone would have been, whoa, this Shaft guy might be going to jail. Like, you know, you say you didn't throw him out of the window and he fell and all that. We don't have any witnesses and he died from your office. And, you know, that alone, much less you went out and did all this shooting and looting and burning in a white neighborhood. And this is just, we let old Shaft go. You know, he saved us from having a big race riot and having to bring the tanks up to the village to keep order. Like, are you serious? None of that is believable, realistic. That's why I said, I think Gordon Parks or whomever else, when they read the book, like, yeah, that's kind of goofy. That's why they changed a lot of that stuff up at the end. The movie doesn't end that way. They don't have any sort of trial, and they talk about, well, Shaft did some sort of community service, and these white guys were evil, no-count thugs and gangsters and all the rest of it. That doesn't even happen. In fact, the movie, they get Beatrice back, and Andrazi, he's on the phone talking to Shaft. It's like, what is going on? We got all this chaos and blah, 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 and all the rest of it. Who's going to fix all of this? And Shaft just tells him, you clean it up, shitty, laughs and hangs up the phone, and that's it. Which is better than this, because, I mean, that's not believable either. But to have it that the commissioner, white commissioner, comes in and does all this to hook Shaft up and get him a, like, come on. Let's see. Anything else from... Yeah, the investor, he wrote in about the scene with the child. I thought it was interesting that Marvin is never there either, so you never even see this black father who's working and not doing anything crazy. You never even meet his character. Let's see. And then the last sentence where Shaft, he's going to go to the airport. He doesn't know where he's going. San Francisco, Paris, Tokyo. I don't know. I'm going to go somewhere, get out of this city, out of these people, out of his own skin. Not even possible. And Ernest Tidyman knows this. Is nowhere you're gonna go. Are you serious? I'm gonna go to San Francisco, California in 1971 and think I'm gonna get away from racism, white supremacy, me being a black person? Are you serious? Paris, France? We were just talking about the battle for Algiers. They weren't even done with all their colonialism and getting rid of, you know, we're going to be terrorizing black people all over the continent, Shaft in Africa. That's still going on in 1970. Why would that be? Oh, I can go get away from racism. Or Rio de Janeiro, he mentioned that too. That's Mr. Fuller's fantasy. Now, he said he recognized real quick by the time he got into the armed services and going to participate in what they call the Korean War, he recognized then, like, dang, it is no place I can go. Not South America, not Iwo Jima, not Japan. There is no place I can go in the known universe to get away from racism. If Mr. Fuller, who himself says, I am greatly retarded because of racism, if he had already come to that conclusion, Ernest Tidyman, who is not dumb, had worked for the New York Times, he had to know this. Get away from my skin. And incidentally, he made a big to-do about Shaft being a Vietnam veteran and Shaft growing up in foster care. Like, that's not a major theme of this book at all. I think there are two men. It's way more like homoeroticism and him sleeping with white people than any sort of focus or attention, or even put that in some context for Shaft being a Vietnam veteran or Shaft being a foster child. Like, these are just kind of quick asides that keep moving. It's like, I can totally see how Gordon Parks, Richard Roundtree, like, yeah, we'll just leave that out completely. It's not even, it's no detail. Like, we would have to add to it to even include any of that into the story. Why include it? Let's just, you know, stick to the meat of the script, which is sex machine. Guns. Ooh. Let's see.
Can I be heard?
Retired firefighter. Yes, sir.
Yeah. By that time, I also, as I mentioned, Black Panther Party, these are, and other such organizations were, like, the armed forces of white supremacy basically had all of those organizations on the run. They emphatically stated to Black people in this part of the world, okay, we have gave you some welfare in the light of laws that eliminates all of that protesting you were doing, the risk that some of these individuals were taking. From there, we don't want, you know, they started fantasizing things like Africa, because basically we were doing it. We were doing it itself. You know, the whole idea with having the afros started getting bigger and bigger, you know, by that time, with examples of the Jackson Five, they made it popular with these huge afros and whatnot. Hair care products came to make it to make your hair grow in a certain way and still be basically healthy, that sort of thing. And so with movies like this, whether it's Richard Roundtree, Pam Grier, several other actors and actresses, all of those movies had the same plot. Almost to the letter, almost all of those movies. Shaft just haven't been one of the first ones, but it all of them had the same plot. You basically can just take out Mr. Roundtree and put in the gentleman that plays Superfly. it wouldn't be that much of a problem for that person to get it on how the movie is supposed to go. And it ran through, I would say, from 1970 to, let's say, 71. I mean, I'm sorry, 75, something like that. But these type of movies just constantly kept coming out almost every 2 months or so. These movies kept coming out, and they basically had the same plot, the same ending. Most of them could be considered to be action films, the action would ultimately, Black people would see in fantasy, not reality, of black people taking advantage physically, white people, preferably white people that had some power, like the head of some sort of white gangster group of some type, even the police in some case, you know, that sort of thing. That was common. It was common in the movies, that this fantasy like getting at the man, you know, that sort of thing, that people would actually make jokes about it, you know, on the fantasy of it all. So, yeah, that's what the whole atmosphere of the movie Shaft would remind me of. It was just one of the first ones of that particular culture that existed. That's it.
Much obliged, retired firefighter in Florida. Racists do a lot. I mean, fantasy, deception, two words for the same thing. Race soldiers can be very dangerous, effective, I'll say, in really trashing our understanding of the world. To put out lots of this content at that time. And this is one of those, I might even say, because I've been saying, who do we think these films were made for? This might even be one where you get, I think we've talked about this before, you can have a white person and a non-white person in the same classroom, and they're receiving two different lessons. You could have them together in the same movie theater, and they're getting different lessons, different information from the same movie. Where you have Black people in watching something, Shaft or whatever it is, all the rest of these Superfly, and they just kept coming, Coffee Brown and blah, 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 blah. You can have Black people in there watching this and, yeah, that's right, get it to the man, tell us all this goofiness that we heard from Shaft. That's right, go out here and take this from the white people. I go out here and do this. Remember, white people were watching this like, huh. This is so, one, this is so goofy and unrealistic, like no threat to us at all. Two, you can actually just go and enjoy the goofiness of all this, because all of those, and I mean all, no misses, all of these films, you got all your violence, you got all of the gratuitous sexual content, like that was bragged about with Pam Grier, and a sex machine that just continues all the way throughout all these super flies, so you can go and enjoy, be sexually titillated with all of your fantasies of having sex with a black female or a black male or both, and enjoy all the goofy entertainment because it's got some explosions and gun battles, goofy black people, and it's not revealing any truth about white supremacy racism. And white people at MGM and all these other studios making a killing off of the money. So it's one of those, I'd say, hey, you will have lots of those type of situations where we could be in the theater or reading the same book and be getting totally different messages about racism, white supremacy, our understanding of the world, how we're supposed to function, especially if you got black people watching this content, Shaft, and they're confused about racism, white supremacy, like, oh man, you will be even more confused now. Go and get 3, 4, 5 doses of Shaft. Go out and get you a leather coat and think you can conquer the world. Leather coat and a turtleneck. That's it. Leather coat and a turtleneck. Alrighty. Let's see. We'll get to the teaser. So we technically are done with Shaft, but this is the teaser. They had to give us a little bit of Shaft among the Jews. See if we would be excited enough to go get a copy of that. Maybe to read all 6 in the series. Not. I guess just be mindful, because the same person wrote all these books, so I guess be mindful if you see any of the same patterns. We'll see if it's got the same gratuitous focus on the black male penis and sex with white people. I have no idea how much time is going to be devoted to specifically what Shaft's gripe or problem is with so-called Jews, if that term is even explained. But we'll go ahead and get to the teaser, and then we'll be for real, done with Shaft. So this is Shaft Amongst the Jews. This is in the copy of the book that I have and the audio book. So I guess they intended for folks to give a little bit more. We'll hear what they give us in the first portion, and then we'll give our final thoughts. Context of White Supremacy, Ernest Tidyman.
And now, an advanced look at Ernest Tidyman's John Shaft in Shaft Among the Jews, read by Will Dixon of Skeleton Crew. Coming soon from Dynamite. Shaft Among the Jews. 1. Shaft regarded his office with sympathy, sorrow, and some anger. An old friend had been murdered in his sleep. It was the same thing. The orange daybed shrieked all over the corner where it was supposed to wait quietly until he needed a place to crash. The bright blue carpeting was committing violence from wall to wall as well as end to end of the color spectrum. Oh, Jesus, he muttered, spinning his chair around away from the see-through plastic desk that was a special agony to his senses, but almost lost in the abundance of his pain. Turning away didn't help. En route, Shaft had been forced to take in another startling assessment of the stark white filing cabinets, the polished aluminum frame around his license as a private investigator, the pale blue telephone with its attached and color-coordinated blue-gray memo pad, the polished steel abstraction that seemed to be lurching drunkenly across the small side table next to the daybed. Even the window that looked out on the honky-tonk of Times Square at 46th Street was no help. The neon splatter out there, enhanced by the darkness that seemed to descend right after lunch in November, was almost lost in the reflected glare of the disaster behind him. Why, John Shaft wondered, had he let her talk him into this? Listen, he could have said, I'll fuck the faggot. You redecorate the office. You know, have the walls painted, the floors swept or something. Maybe you could get the cheap bastard who owns the building to clean out the crapper down the hall. I'd rather piss in a Tennessee gas station than go in there. He hadn't. Instead, he had made the mistake of accepting her pretensions. It was the price of pussy. And now he was paying it, in an atmosphere that jangled the nerves he was supposed to have assuaged with 3 weeks of stringing them out on the sands of Jamaica. He turned the brown-black oval face away from the window to scowl over his shoulder at the awfulness of it,
and the blue and orange began playing tricks on his eyes, flicking the focus of his retina back and forth like an optic switch. "God damn," he said aloud. "How did you get into such shit?" "Hello, I understand you're a private eye," she had said, in a soft, whispery voice that sounded like a child play-acting at being very nice. It was no child attached to the sound, though. She was tall, blonde, and slender, with a face that might have been carved carefully out of golden beeswax. She had spent a lot of summer in the sun, and it was still there. "Yeah," he said. His eyes had done the normal thing before responding, counting the long legs, the slope of her breasts, and the lean and even turn of her arms and neck. It didn't bother her. She wasn't self-conscious about anything she had, and it was there to look at. "Killed anybody lately?" she asked, hiding the smile with the rim of the highball glass. "One of those. They opened the wrong door someplace about 6 or 8 years ago, and all those goddamn game players came out. Only my appetite by coming to this collection of assholes," he said. That got a nice flicker out of the back of her gray-blue eyes. Now she'd either figure him for decent competition and turn on the heat, or run like hell for some less suspicious prey on the other side of the room. That star dummy type over there in the blue cardan suit, who wouldn't even feel the incision as his balls were being removed. But she didn't do either. "If you think you can breathe some life back into it," she said, "why don't we split for something more pleasant then?" "Yeah," he agreed, following her lead as she turned and began to move through the small crush of cocktail drinkers and gossip merchants who had gathered for this bash at the apartment of his actor friend, Raleigh Nickerson. She had a nice ass, he thought, as she moved 2 or 3 people ahead of him. A great ass. "Hey, brother, you going already?" Raleigh asked as they snaked past the bar at the entrance of the kitchen. Nickerson, a tall, angular man who hadn't done much in the theater since Abraham Lincoln and basketball players went out of style, could peer over the tops of assorted heads to the object of Shaft's attention. "Yeah, John, baby," he answered his own question. "You gone." That's how he got into these things. Just like that. It was maybe the damnedest night of all the strange ones in his 30 years of them, and it wasn't over yet. They had walked east to the west side's smudgy, smelly middle 50s, where Raleigh Nickerson and virtually every other unsuccessful actor in New York lived. There was none of the hesitant pause of new acquaintances between them. She took his hand as soon as they hit the sidewalk. They stayed linked together that way until they fell into the San Marco, a small Italian place just west of 6th. "I don't know," he said, holding the door. "I've only been for lunch," she said, "but they really care about food." He went through a steak and a pasta something on the side. She had anchovies and peppers, gave him a bite, and toyed with a salad. They talked about some things. What, he never remembered. Exactly, except the idea came through that she wasn't playing games with him. Maybe it was just that she wasn't afraid of him, or wanting to screw his head around for a variety of neurotic reasons. Maybe that was it. She was coming on straight, and there weren't many like that. They were so rare, in fact, that it took some doing to come back at them straight. "You have any good music we could listen to?" "Yeah," he said, "but your apartment's a god-awful mess, right?" John Shaft had smiled. There was a disarming quality in the way it lighted the usually cold and noncommittal mask, deceptive as the smile of a man built on such wide, powerful lines along a 6-foot frame. And there was a demoniacal cast to the smile provided by the scars he had accumulated. A bicycle chain stitching above the right eye, the nicks and slashes of the pistol whipping he had taken in search for Beatrice Persons a year ago. No, almost 2 now. "It's not a mess," he defended the apartment. "It's just confused. Mine's probably closer anyhow. I'm on 64th between Madison and Park." "That's a lot closer." It kept occurring to Shaft that he should find out what her name was somewhere along the line, but the conversation never got there. She knew his, and he wasn't going to say anything like, "Okay, I'm John Shaft, and I'm a private eye. Now who and what are you?" It wasn't his style. There were too many things happening between them. What difference did the name make? He'd find out eventually or never. It still wouldn't make any difference. The reality of it was that she was sitting there. He was sitting there. And they were getting up to go to her apartment over on 64th Street between Madison and Park because his apartment was confused. He had a momentary flash of the confusion. He hadn't made the bed for 3 girls in 2 weeks. There was a Chemex filter full of 3-day-old grounds on the stove. Every ashtray in the place was strangling in debris of spasmodic tensions. Smudged, smeared glasses containing the last drops of yesterday's celebrations were glued to the small tables and even the top of the refrigerator. and a Hindu firewalker probably wouldn't go across the floor in his bare feet without complaining bitterly. He had walked to her place. It was nothing like his own, sitting on the relatively calm corner at Jane Street and Hudson, on the western frontier of Greenwich Village. Her building probably used to be a private home, converted 15 or 20 years ago into a sandwich stack of small apartments, squeezed between two huge slices of sandstone, one of them an elegant hotel, the other taken over as an embassy that had more meaning than the millionaire who built it. The name on her door was A. Taylor Davis. "Which one are you?" he asked. In the heartland of a new marriage that consists of two people and one mailbox hyphen, following her into a large, high-ceilinged room that seemed to be all dark browns and golds with red and pink fabric splashes and pillows and draperies. "All of them," she said over her shoulder, moving through the room and straight back to another that he could see to be a small bedroom when she touched on a light. "Amy Taylor Davis." There's a hyphen between Taylor and Davis. He was looking around the room. There was a circular table in the far corner, diagonally opposite the door, covered with a bright gold tablecloth, and holding a glob of ceramic that made a nice lamp, a collection of small silver photo frames or faces he couldn't see and wouldn't recognize. There was a long, heavy-looking couch of dark brown suede on a stainless steel frame, and in front of that, a low glass and a stainless steel table, and under it, a rich gold-colored oriental rug that seemed to pull it all together. There was a big leather wing-back chair with bright brass tacks trimming all its edges, and on the cream-yellow wall, John. He'd been thinking that it was a rich room, a tasteful and expensive room. You see a room like that in a magazine sometimes. People wanted to know the difference between the rest of New York and the Upper East Side. Tell them it was a room like this, because it said who the people were and what they were like. And he'd also been thinking that if he sat down on the big brown couch and she sat down next to him, they were going to talk for an hour or so, and he was going to try to score. Oh, yes, he was. Because she had one hell of a John. It startled him, and he didn't startle easy. Did she want him in the bedroom? Didn't she know he was busy trying to figure out how to ball her on the brown couch 2 hours from now? He tossed the tan, belted raincoat on the couch and moved toward the sound of her voice. She was standing in front of a dressing table mirror next to the bed, shadow lighted in the dim light from the single small lamp, twisted around trying to see the back of her neck in the mirror. Her arms were raised and both her hands were around at the back of her neck, at the catch of the zipper, a position that lifted her breasts and thrust the slopes and rising peaks against the fabric of the light wool dress. "Help me with this damn thing," she said. "Man, what the hell am I into?" he wondered, only briefly. The catch on the zipper really was stuck, and his fingers felt as big as bananas as he pulled and twisted at it for 2 minutes. Nothing. "Force it. Tear it apart. I'll ruin it." "Rip the goddamn thing open," she said. Shaft ripped. The stubborn zipper and the fabric parted at their mutual seam, and the light wool slashed open on peach-pink flesh to the beginning shadow of her bottom's round cheeks. The only thing to do was get out of there and let her repair the shambles. She interrupted his apologies and his movements, turning toward him with a soft smile of shared conquest of the zipper, and began shrugging out of the remains of the dress as they spoke. "Thank you." She was not wearing a brassiere. Her breasts were small but perfect, firm cones. The nipples were dark, but not very dark. And he knew that they would be large in his hands or against his lips if and when she was aroused. The dry cleaners do that to clothes. Her body was lean, and there was only a ripple of flesh, not fat, as she bent to lower the remains of the dress to the floor and step out of it. And her belly was flat, almost concave, in the pelvic hollow behind the brown-toned top of her pantyhose. She kicked the mound of torn wool toward a wastebasket that stood beside the dressing table and hooked her finger in the last garment. He hadn't noticed until then that she had slipped out of her shoes. "There's a suit hanger in the armoire there, on the right. Why don't you hang your suit there?" Gauzy, clinging nylon went smoothly, silently down long columns of legs. He was startled on the level of astonishment. He thought for a moment that she had no pubic hair and then saw when she straightened to toss the hose on a small chair in front of the dressing table that it was so golden light as to be almost invisible against the light skin. "Over there." Nodding toward the cupboard and turning away, she walked away from him toward the bed. A truly incredible ass. Tilting upward toward him as she bent over the bed and pulled back the rich blue coverlet comforter on butter-yellow sheets and pillows, raising a knee and climbing into the bed that way to settle back against a pillow. She found a cigarette in a small silver box on a stand beside the bed, lit it, and looked at him, smiling.
Whenever you're ready, John.
Why should he feel slightly embarrassed? Ready? He was so ready, he would probably have difficulty getting his tight tailored trousers down over his royal readiness.
In the armoire there.
She nodded toward it again. He went across to it, away from her, and opened the right-hand door and found the hanger. He took his jacket off, looking back at her, maybe to make sure she was still there.
Well, fuck it.
If that's the way it was, then that's the way it was. I didn't want to rush or charge into this or do a lot of groping or grabbing. He hooked the red silk tie on the armoire key temporarily, unbuttoned the shirt, and slipped it off. His easy, almost time-dislocated pace puzzled him. He felt under a control, a governor on the racing engine of what he wanted, what he desired. Each foot rose with a slow heaviness to his hands, for a flicking of the laces and slipping out of them.
I want every detail of this with you, John. And I want you to have it, too, to savor it. Drink deeply of it.
Oh, Jesus, yes, he needed a drink. Of it, of anything. The trousers and the shorts came off with the slight difficulty he expected, and he stood there with them in his hand for a moment, trying to make sure the change did fall out of his pocket, and he turned them upside down for hanging.
Mr. Shaft, did anyone ever tell you you are built like a brick shithouse?
Do you walk to the bed or run? Or float? He floated. Never touched the floor at all, in the dreamy, creamy waves of movement that carried him to the bed, and there... She moved a few inches away to make room for him. He felt the stallion surge of demand that has torn asunder civilizations for its immediate gratification. But he couldn't reach for her. She wouldn't let him.
Don't fondle me, darling. I don't need it. I've been wet for you since I looked at you at the party and thought of you inside of me.
He would go insane. His eyes would pop and his brain would explode. His flesh would disintegrate under the pressure. There was no standing this. What was she doing? What did she want?
Here, get here on your knees.
Soft hands, fire trailing exposed wires, guided him to his knees before her as she drew up her long, slender legs. Ankles, knees, and thighs continued to rise, and she held them toward the ceiling and then parted them slightly. He was entranced by the ritual, man kneeling at his altar, her ankles lowered to his shoulders softly, easily.
You have a beautiful penis, she said,
cold, clinical, educated word. It was his cock. His jollop, his meat, his licorice stick. It was 735 dirty words of humping, fucking, bawling, making it. But it might never again be anything but this that she had called, and now touched, and now guided.
Slowly, John,
she said in caution to the first fire of the open flesh.
And look at us. Look at your strength entering me, penetrating. Is it sweet? Is it warm? Is it beautiful to behold?
He groaned. Every tissue, bone, and muscle of his strong body had been refined and focused to this one place, this one thing.
Try not to come, darling. Not yet. I want to suck you into me centimeter by centimeter of your sweet black flesh, and let us feel each other and see each other so that this will always be part of us.
And somehow, flesh walls of the valley of ecstasy began to contract and draw him deeper. Deeper until the golden floss and his black strands were touching and entangled, and he was in a place in such a way as had never happened before. The bottoms of her thighs were against his chest, and she was curled truly beneath his weight, the mouth open and inches from his own.
Oh, I wanted to fuck you, she whispered,
relinquishing control and unleashing the rhythmic frenzy into which they then struggled. Well, that's how he got into the orange couch with a blue rug and a plastic desk and all the rest of the shit that was probably going to drive him up the wall or out the window ledge, hanging like a mad monkey over a frayed and frazzled world in which he was at least comfortable. God damn it, he thought. Why'd he ever brought her up to the office in the first place? Because his awareness answered truthfully. She was in charge and had been right from the first. Herzl was angry, disillusioned, and bitter. It so filled his small old body, bent under the weight of years and the lifelong habit of leaning over the microscope and the laboratory table, that his sleep had been destroyed long before dawn, and he had come awake with a curse on his lips. He apologized immediately to God and arose to read and pray. There was some relief in it, but no solace. He was fully aware now that they regarded him as a fool, a brilliant fool, perhaps, who had stumbled upon a dream, but still a fool. After he had prayed, Herzl permitted himself the warmth and succor of tea. He moved very quietly on crushed felt slippers through the kitchen of the small white house. His daughter slept only 20 or 30 feet away in the only room of the house that could be called a bedroom, and he did not want to discuss his problems with her. She was a loving girl, a beautiful girl, but there was about her that certain arrogance he had both encountered and sensed in the last several weeks of his dealing with the ministries and officials. Their bright, hard faces and their bright, hard minds would not open to the premise of his proposal. He had not told them everything. He had told her nothing. And now he sighed with the lonely weight of those decisions and sipped at the tea. In the cold and silent hours of the morning, he thought of his wife, gone so many years in the final flight from his sorrows, yet still so close that the invocation of her presence was the warmth of a shawl across his bony shoulders. He could have spoken to her of this, and she would have understood. There would have been some practical suggestion, for she had been an immensely practical person, or some insightful word or two about the way of things and the people he had encountered in the government offices. "Avram, you know," she would remind him deferentially of something he did not know at all until she propounded it, and the way would be clear. Avram Herzl sat nodding and bent on the straight-backed chair. Wisps of white hair brushed neatly beneath the black yarmulke, and reached a hand into the inner pocket of the plain gray-black suit he wore over a white shirt, its collar open, and brought forth the small folded square of tissue paper. His slender, age-whitened fingers unfolded the paper carefully until the contents of the packet lay bare in the first sharp shock of dawn that assaulted the window on his kitchen. The four stones lay glittering, almost obscenely rich in such a simple place. A 7-carat diamond, flashing blue fire, a 5-carat emerald of green depths from the very bottom of the soul, and the round and bloody fury of a ruby of 10 or 11 carats, and the second diamond, larger than the first, perhaps 9 carats of cold, fierce flame. "See," he implored, "do you see the beauty of this work I have done?" He spoke as he spoke to his God, or the memory of his wife, as he spoke to them both at least once a day, with the hope, but not the expectation, of an answer. Morris Blackburn felt as if his skin had been set on fire. Even the backs of his small, pudgy hands blazed. It was like nothing he had ever felt since his childhood in Europe, when he had somehow been infested with vermin and had undergone a hideous but thorough cleansing at the hands of his father. His small, squirming body had been doused then with kerosene, an icy brutality that quickly turned to flame, even though the old man set about almost instantly to scrub away this foulest of antiseptics with laundry soap and hot water. His skin had burned for days then, with what seemed to be 100 embarrassments, as it burned now, and the voice on the telephone continued to drawl on in that merciless nasal condescension of the American rich. "Well, Morris, we've been friends for such a long time. I am really, really just incredulous that a thing of this magnitude could happen, but..." The butt was $160,000 worth of black pearl. Morris Blackburn's flaming flesh began to sweat. He wanted to rip off all his fine clothes and flee into the street and the cold November wind pushing soot clouds up Fifth Avenue. Only the rock-hard, gem-hard discipline of his world and the world of the precious stone held him there, grasping the telephone, his mind racing at incredible speed on 3 levels, to control his intense discomfort, to think of a solution to this ghastly situation, to find a way of protecting his position. Morris Blackburn was beautiful, truly beautiful. He was tall and slender, with dark and tightly curled hair that brushed gray at the temples and forelock. Not too gray, but just gray enough for a man who was vigorously 50, but might have been 40 until the lines around the eyes and under the chin deepened in laughter or concentration or fatigue. His suit was beautiful, too. It was designed for him by Mark Bohan of Dior, a chocolate-brown gesture of distinguished softness into which a cream stripe had been woven. He wore it with a vest, and under that a beige shirt of the softest, silkiest cotton, with a massively knotted tie of yet another shade of brown, and red-brown English boots on his smallish, narrow feet. "Morris is so goddamn beautiful, I feel vulgar paying his bills," the widow of a broadcasting corporation executive announced one night in noting his exquisite presence at a party that they both happened to attend. "He looks more like an Italian hee-haw than a jeweler." But he was a jeweler, and his beauty was both his success and his affliction. With Tiffany, Cartier, Van Cleef and Arpels, Harry Winston, David Webb, and a few others dangling their glittering enticements all around them, the very rich were most likely to buy the imagination of the salesmanship with their baubles. And Morris, for example, could sell a small pearl and diamond tiara to a young duchess of Grosse Pointe's greasy pit aristocracy while they burrowed into the coverlet. And she giggled self-consciously at the canopy on his quite authentic Louis XIV bed. But he would also have to agree, several weeks later on, the afternoon after they had found an unusual but highly rewarding position involving the top of his desk, that she did not have to tell her husband just how much it cost. Not until he was through with the strain of exercising all those stock options, or whatever they were. Of course, Morris could wait. Financial patience was as much a part of Morris Blackburn's sales approach as the black velvet against which he liked to display both his merchandise and himself in all their naked brilliance. Waiting, waiting, for the once royal of a democratized, socialized, aggrandized world to commit their remaining resources to the extravagances they were trained to indulge, for the wives of politicians to see their husbands in power again, profiting again, settling the grocers, the jewelers, and all the other accounts again, waiting, as the men who deal in precious stones have always waited, first for the discovery in the earth, the slow cutting and faceting, the setting and selling, and most finally, the paying. It was very expensive to wait. The waiting was half the price paid for of any of it. And for an impatient man like Morris Blackburn, who loved the taste of success, it was the highest price to pay. He had no choice except to cheat. If the fat sow had not been so incredibly clumsy as to drop one of the earrings on the marble floor, if she had not been so unbelievably blind as to step on it in the hysteria of her search, if she had not been so impossibly stupid as to take it to Palm Beach dime store jeweler for repairs instead of shipping it back to him immediately, and if the jeweler in Palm Beach had not been so vicious, unconsciously vicious, as to express deep admiration for the quality of such a realistic piece of fakery. "My dear Edward," Morris Blackburn said into the telephone, his face suddenly as warm and ingratiating as the voice, "calm yourself. Our little deceit has made you much too angry. Smile. You must have beautiful weather there, and let me explain. You remember how terribly impatient Julia was for the earrings? Of course you do. Well, a small, time-consuming problem developed in the safety lock on the pin of one of the pearls, a problem that we have just now solved, and let me assure you that it is right here in the vault, if you need such insurance." "Well, Morris, But Julia couldn't wait, could she? So I simply substituted our design model for the problem earring until such a time." He talked very quickly, very smoothly. He had been told that he looked like an actor. Perhaps he should have been one. There was no black pearl in the vault. But he was racing for the curtain of the first act. Morris Blackburn knew he could play it to the end if he just had a brief intermission. Max Lishkin felt as relaxed as he ever got as soon as the lousy piece of junk he got from the car rental agency moved out of the business area and onto the open highway to the Miami airport. He reached out with his left hand and rolled down the window, eye on the road, tight one-hand hold on the wheel, letting the soft coolness of the Florida night flush out the ashtray odor he had been closed in with since he'd left the garage. Lishkin did not smoke, and the ashtray smell was one of the annoyances he bore whenever he was closed up in a car or even a room where the housekeeping had not been quite to his fastidious standard. There were many other conditions of this sort that annoyed this short, round man who wore a plainly cut dark gray suit, a light blue shirt that had been starched into a state of endurance for his travels. He carried no extra clothes with him, occasionally buying a shirt, generally washing out his socks and underwear in the bathroom basin of his hotel room. He never expressed these individual annoyances, but sometimes complained lightly that the only thing wrong with people was their habits, their bad habits. For Max Lishkin had no habits, except the habit of having no others. It had been almost 30 years in which he had never done the same thing in the same place for two consecutive days. It led to this sort of dialogue between his closest associations. "So, where's Max? Who knows? Max knows. So ask Max." He was not to be expected anywhere at any given time. Home? He had two small rooms, one in Brooklyn, the other in his sister's large apartment on West End Avenue in Manhattan. He slept at one or the other on alternate nights, when he did not check into a small hotel or the Sloan House, YMCA, on far west 34th Street, or a health club in which he maintained a membership. He traveled to them by subway, bus, cab, foot, and sometimes rented car, which was also the non-pattern of his travels throughout the country and occasionally abroad. While he would have saved what could have amounted to years of time by flying, Max Lishkin had seen Dallas through the window of a Greyhound bus, the outskirts of Tulsa from the diner of a train, the route from San Francisco to Denver through the windshields of various cars, and a lot of the Atlantic Ocean through a portal. Now he was going to fly back to New York after a reasonably successful 3-day trip to Miami because he had been summoned through the double and triple relays of answering services, message drops, to an important meeting the following morning. But no one really knew for sure that he was coming or how. Thus, he was considerably surprised in the airport parking lot when he bent over his belly to pull up on the emergency brake and felt the very cold muzzle of a small caliber pistol pressed to the side of his head. Who, he wondered, dying? Max Lishkin's worn and inexpensive-looking black attaché case caught the next plane for New York. It contained $97,000 worth of loose diamonds, which was a very meager and disappointing haul. But as one of the world's great diamond salesmen, Max had disposed of more than $2 million worth during his 3 days of making the rounds of jewelers in the Miami area, a sale that was his custom as the resort season began, if not his habit. Well, fuck it, Shaft thought, pushing out the new black leather chair. He had his fill of the office. He had that about 3 minutes after he had unlocked the door and scooped the accumulated mail off the floor. At some point during the afternoon, he should have called her office and said that he was back, that they could have dinner that night, that they could proceed immediately to bed or the nearest clearing in the traffic, vehicular or pedestrian, and start catching up on his 3 weeks' absence. But he was in no mood for that. He felt like the victim of an obscene practical joke. Mr. Cinderella, or whatever the hell his name was, had showed him some sketches and twittered at him about colors, but Shaft had apparently closed his ears in either the rush to get out of town or maybe some inner resentment at having agreed to let an aspect of his lifestyle go to some external command. Shaft got his raincoat from the windowsill where he had thrown it in sulky defiance of the white porcelain wall hooks and fought the wool of his blue blazer past the fabric liner of the coat, with passing thought that the raincoat lining must undergo some special treatment to make them difficult to get into. With both big, needy hands, he began picking up stacks of mail and stuffing the envelopes into the coat's saddlebag pockets. He wasn't sure where he was going. Maybe some quiet bar down in the village, except there weren't any quiet bars in the village, or maybe to his apartment. Maybe he ought to call the answering service. He started to reach for the telephone. Fuck that, too. Whatever, whoever it could wait another day. The only family he ever had was the welfare department, and he hadn't been in communication since the judge let him join the army to go to NAM instead of the street hoodlums' postgraduate classes behind bars. And that was a long time ago. Friends. Who did he know in the friendless, detached, and survival-focused New York out there who could pause long enough to wonder if Shaft was back in town? He got ready to leave, grabbing up the cigarettes and matches, and for some reason thinking momentarily about the lifeguard on the beach at Montego Bay. The big, muscular black man, bigger by 30 pounds than Shaft, had said that Americans didn't know how to roll a joint, proceeded to take out a ditty bag of native ganja, rolled a big fat one, and blow it right there in the Caribbean sunshine. Hello? Cowboys and Indians. The disembodied head that peered around the door from the third-floor hallway was wearing a heavy black beard and a big black sombrero. Well, there were funnier-looking things swimming around in the dark waters of Times Square. No reason he should be surprised that one of them came into his old building. Yeah? The cowboy's response was just to look around the office slowly and carefully, then back to Shaft. I know how you feel, Shaft said, pushing down the envelopes in his pockets, beginning to button the coat. Shaft, just like on the door. We would like a few words with you. We? You want to talk in here or out there in the hallway? The cowboy came into the office then. Excuse me, he said, turning back to look over his shoulder with a nod of approval. There were seven of them, all cowboys, except they weren't cowboys. But they were something. In assorted shapes, sizes, and ages, the seven men who filed into his office were identical in dress, each one wearing a wide-brimmed black hat, long and dark outer coat, dark suits with vests, white shirts, and black old-fashioned-looking shoes. They all had beards and curls hanging down around in front of or over their ears. Shaft remembered meeting a writer in the no-name bar across the street from his apartment house one night, and the guy telling him his next book would be Great Jewish Gunfighters of the Old West. Beginning with Coward Cohen, in Cimarron, and ending in a puff of gun smoke with Rapid Rabinowitz in Dodge City. The memory made him smile. Nobody smiled back. The men crowding into the office, standing closely together like visitors to an alien, unsafe land, continued to inspect him and his surroundings. He became aware, of course, that they were not cowboys, that he had seen the darkly suited and heavily hatted men and their beards crossing his path briskly, brusquely, always quite vigorously on a number of occasions. He had assumed that they were Jewish simply because they appeared to be Jewish, assumed without really thinking it out that their more formal attire signified some special position or purpose in life. Rabbis, perhaps. The thought occurred to him now that seven rabbis had come to see him, and it troubled him because Shaft did not believe in God or organized religion or anything much except himself, and he wasn't sure how to act toward people who did, especially people who believed so much that they worked at it 9 to 5. "You want to find some place to sit down?" he asked. At least the distribution of their somber clothes around the room would cover part of the color scheme. As they found places on the couch and in two black chairs that matched his own, and two, the youngest of them, remained standing against the wall, Shaft speculated that maybe one of their associates had disappeared with the collection plate, and they didn't want to cause a scandal by blowing the whistle on him publicly. "Well, if God didn't know where this cat was, how could..."
"Thank you," said the leader of the group.
"We wish to inquire into your services on our behalf."
"Doing what?"
"An investigation. An inquiry which must be extremely fast, yet discreet. And so, of course, we must first know what you do." Shaft thought at first that they knew what he did, or they wouldn't be there, crowded into his office like a new rock band looking for the bread to get their guitars out of Ock. Some place in one of the file cabinets on the side of the room, he had all the clippings from the Daily News and the others about who he was and what he had done.
"Well, maybe you read about one of my cases in the paper," he began.
They looked horrified. "I mean, how did you pick up on?"
"We read about you in the Yellow Pages," the lead vocalist said.
"That was a kick in the ass, and it got worse.
You were the closest one."
That was almost as depressing as the discovery that his office had become a setting for a Halloween party with everything except pumpkins. It gave him the status of, say, the nearest men's room on a cold day. He wished he had left the office 5 or 10 minutes before they decided to come into it.
"Yeah, well, like it says there in the Yellow Pages, I'm a private investigator. I handle some things that the police don't do, some things the police can't do."
That seemed to please them. They all nodded. He wondered why they didn't take their hats off.
"And like in places where there's no proof of a crime having been committed, but some suspicion, maybe I can find out if that suspicion is worth turning over to the police before somebody gets all involved and hurt without it being necessary."
They continued to nod. So he went on and told them about divorce cases, at which they all frowned, how he sometimes had posed as a porter in big stores like Saks Fifth Avenue and Gimbel's to look into pilferage problems. They stopped frowning and got into a lot of things where nobody would expect a black man to be, which made it easier for him to operate and gather information quietly without raising the barriers of suspicion, which was very pleasing. And he thought he felt a breeze raised by the up-and-down movement of seven wide-brimmed hats.
"And how much does this cost?"
"Well, the rates vary, but mostly I get $15 an hour now.
And expenses?"
"Expenses?" Big frowns all around. "Phone calls, taxi fares. Maybe I have to buy some information."
"Why do you have to buy information if you get $15 an hour to find it out yourself?"
Now Shaft frowned.
"Because sometimes it's the only way, the fast way. There's people who have information who don't understand anything, who can't even hear anything except the rustling noise that money makes when you rub a handful of it together right in their ears."
That they understood. There was a generous round of nods. Shaft noticed that a couple of them were inspecting the office very closely, as if they were estimating the cost of such outrageous frippery in a business place. One, on the far end of a couch, picked up a green-gray ashtray from a little table beside him and looked at the bottom of it. Shaft wished he'd steal the goddamn thing, slip it into the folds of the long black coat.
"Okay," he asked, "would you gentlemen like to discuss something specific with me?"
"Please excuse us for a moment,"
the spokesman said, turning around in the chair to face the others, then looking back to ask,
"Do you understand Yiddish?"
"What?
Yiddish?
No." The elder nodded and turned to the others again to begin. Shaft expected it would be a few exchanges that would decide whether they wanted to tell him what it was all about, and then maybe a request that he handle their problem, whatever the hell it might be. What he got, or felt he was getting, was a debate on the beginning and end of mankind, with serious review of the causes, and all of it in a language he could not understand. Each one of the seven men in the room apparently had a speech to make, and each one had a strong counter-proposal and a counter-counter-proposal. Shaft sat back in his chair and listened for a while. He couldn't understand a word. He thought he caught the name Schwartz being fired back and forth several times and speculated that perhaps a man named Schwartz was their big problem. It was going too fast for him to decipher that it was Schwarze, the Yiddish for Negro, and realized that they were discussing him. He lit a cigarette, turned to look out the window at Times Square. When the cigarette was done, he turned back. They were still at it. He lit another and started to look through the mail he had in his pockets. They argued through 27 advertisements, 14 bills, 2 postcards, a note from a cat he knew in the army who was now in federal penitentiary at Danbury and wanted help, and a notice from his landlord that he was in trouble for repainting without permission. It was such a terrible thing he had permitted to be done that his rent would probably be raised in keeping with the bright new look of his premises. Landlords thought that way. Shaft looked at his watch. 20 minutes at least. And still they talked. He thought about dinner, drinks, unpacking his bags, taking a shower, getting laid, trying a taste of the Jamaican boo he had smuggled back with him. He was tired. Then he thought of throwing them the hell out of there. This was turning into one huge pain in the ass. Okay, okay. He interrupted a vigorous declamation from a man about 30 with a bright red beard and what seemed to be the stamina for several hours more of this. They all turned to him, but he spoke to the leader. I'm splitting, man. I'm tired and I'm dirty and I'm hungry. Why don't you just take Dopey, Sneezy, Sleepy, and Grouchy out of here and go see if you can find Snow White. Maybe figure out what the hell you want. I'll be back in the morning. Give me a call. Of course, the leader said. More talk is unnecessary, but we are a committee and everyone must participate fully. We have decided.
Decided what?
That we wish to retain you to find out what is happening in our business. The diamond business.
What's wrong with it?
No one knows, except something unusual is happening.
Well, that's nothing to think about.
Not in your business, perhaps. Not in all others. But in the diamond business, there is never... And his voice sounded stern and filled with righteousness. There is never even the slightest whisper... A suspicion of something unusual, but that concern. Even fear does not rise in the hearts of 1,000 men. Something unusual does not happen more than once in a century. And it is happening now.
Shaft paused over that a moment. But how or what do you want me to do? What do you want to know?
Everything from the movement of the smallest speck of dust to the cutting of the largest stone that is not done today as it was yesterday, as it was the day before that.
Everything. That's impossible. Need 100 people like me for that.
No? Just one. With the minds and eyes and ears of the rest of us. And you will do the work of 100 men.
Hey, man, he started to protest, thinking that he couldn't get that tied up for 15 an hour in tokens, that they were all crazy anyhow and would cramp his style.
Your payment for this will be realistic and honest, since we cannot function any other way. There will be an extremely small percentage of the total gross for all of us. We are just a committee representing many more. If you are able to provide a solution to our problem.
There was an interruption in Yiddish from the couch.
The leader acknowledged the reminder. But no expenses, he said. Shaft's quick resentment reminded him that he didn't like Jews. He was tired, annoyed, and hardly rational about what he resented. The chiseling bastards.
Yeah, well, you can just collect yourselves and get the fuck out of here, he said. I'm going to count the ashtrays and go home.
They didn't mind his anger. Let me tell you what the figures for the last year were before you decide not to help us. In 2 or 3 scribbles on his memo pad, a door was open for John Shaft, black private eye on a world he could not and dared not conceive of ever knowing. His fee, if he did everything he was supposed to do, would come to something just over $574,000. He went into a state of financial shock that lasted maybe a second before his imagination began spending it.
This has been a Dynamite Books production.
And with that, we are all done with Shaft. New book for next week. Not sure what it'll be. Folks can chat about that. Compensatory call in or drop an email or whatever. But brand new book for next week. I guess if folks were really excited by that tease, like, hey, let's do Shaft among the Jews. Let us know. I think some of that did get weaved into some of the other Shaft movies that came out subsequently. Shaft's Big Score and Shaft in Africa. Mr. Tidyman also co-wrote the screenplay for Shaft's Big Score. So some of his other novels are kind of thrust into that as well. But what to say? The spawn of a white man. And there's six of these. I can't emphasize that enough. When we think about who do we think he was writing these for? There are six of them. Even let that frame when we think about now, who was Shaft made for again? Six books, three films, and a television show in the 70s. That's not even counting the later iterations of all of this. Number is 720-716-7300. The code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you have a final thought, question on what we've read the last couple of weeks or so, how it compares to the film, a white man being the creator of all this. One of our investors, get his final commentary in now that we are done with the text. Let's see. He continued, I will keep this text in mind when thinking about the recurrent theme of black male homoeroticism and fetishization, which is present in so many of the texts that have been discussed on the COWS. The Delectable Negro, Rethinking Rufus, Apropos of Nothing, among others. Thanks for introducing me to this work. I will never look at the Shaft movies in quite the same way. And how could you? And I feel like that's what it should be like. I think if we want to move this 50 years forward, like I think many of us, whether we're, you know, in our teens, 20s or 60s and beyond, I think many of us are aware of the movies, the Harry Potter movies. I think the bulk of us, regardless of how old, even if we've read them, are aware, oh yeah, that's a series of books that were out first. Same thing with The Hunger Games. Again, I don't think most of us have read The Hunger Games, but I think most of us know, like, oh yeah, that series of films is based on a book. In both instances, written by someone classified as white. Right? Like, even The Godfather, based on a book written by someone. Like, to at least know that, for this to not even be aware that, oh yeah, Sex Machine, Shaft, all that is based on a book, a series of books, but a book written by a white man? And the fact that no one that we've talked to, folks that have called in and said they talked about this with their family and other folks that I've talked to, I said I spoke to Mr. Fuller, not one person. And some of these folks were alive when the film was released. Like, they're not teenagers who, you know, don't know about this ancient film from the 1970s. People who were alive, cognizant, some of them adult. Mr. Fuller, you know, I wish I had asked Dr. Welsing. I wish I had brought this up before she passed. But like, all the folks that we've talked to, not one person, like, oh yeah, I'm not even saying, did you read it? Just were you aware? And again, Ernest Tidyman's name is in big, bold letters at the very beginning of all of the Shad films, even the 1999 one with John Singleton, late John Singleton. Even his name is there, based on the Ernest Tidyman series. Just important, I think. White people slip a lot of things by us and have us convinced that this is authentic black, whatever that means. And let's see. Oh yeah, checking emails. We'll see if folks have any other thoughts they want to make sure they get in and see. Retired firefighter, I'll look for other hands as well. Let's see, I'm looking, because I did take quite a few notes from, I don't even know what you want to call that, Shaft Among the Jews. I did take some notes from that as well, so I'll share a few and see if folks have any thoughts they want to add in as we wrap this up. early this week. I said the book was not very, very long. That was one of the reasons I said, oh, yeah, we should knock this out because we'll be done quick. Let's see. I mean, even now, all the things that I'd said about who's this book intended for, who wants to read this, who wants to see these films, that's the way we start off Shaft among the Jews. All of this X-rated Shaft hooking up with a white woman, which is consistent throughout the books, films. Gotta have a black male with a white man. I mean, at this time, like, who do we think this was for? It's been my experience, or it's my conclusion. Many, many white people, they enjoy this, having some sort of graphic sexual monsters ball. They love this sort of thing. So that's how we start off. All this, like I said, pornographic content, basically. And even before that, he's complaining about the office decor of this white woman. He says, listen, he could have said, I'll F the faggot and you redecorate the office. Now, again, all of this homoeroticism and what is going on. My goodness, you would be censored. They're talking about banning books in Virginia and other places. Like, this book would be censored. Homophobic. Ernest Tidyman, get out of here. Let's see. I don't know what the phrase, I'd rather piss in a Tennessee gas station. I don't know what that means. Like, is that a phrase people know? I've been to the volunteer state repeatedly. I have no, I don't even have a guess. Now, unless this is, since this was written 1971, that time period, this may have been a time period where it may have been a dangerous thing to try to be a black person and use a restroom in Tennessee. That's pretty far south. Maybe. But if that's not what it is, I don't even have a guess as to what that means. Tennessee gas station, are they particularly dangerous to be avoided? Or were they at some time? I don't know. Let's see. And then, again, Shaft being so sex-focused so many times in the movie and in the book, like, that's all he's thinking about is having sexual intercourse. The police stop him in the film. They ask him, where are you going? To get laid. They stop him later on. What were you doing? Getting laid. He's here right at the very beginning of the book. Or it's repeatedly. At the end, he's talking to the Jews. Oh, my gosh, they wasted so much time. I could be doing this. I could be doing that. I could be getting laid. He's here at the beginning with this blonde chick. And, oh, counting her long legs, the slope of her breasts, all this, you know, like I said, pornographic content. It continues. Shaft described as a demon. And again, all of this focus on John Shaft's physicality from a white author. There was a disarming quality in the way it lighted the usually cold and non-committal mask. Deceptive as the smile of a man built on such wide, powerful lines along a 6-foot frame, and there was a demoniacal cast to the smile provided by the scars he had accumulated, the bicycle chain stitching above the right eye, the nicks and slashes of the pistol whipping he had taken in search for Beatrice. Now, again, all of this physical focus on John Shaft's body, and even this scene right here where he's about to have sex with this white woman who is the more powerful person that's written in the text. John, again, that's someone who uses sex workers, pays them for their services or what have you. That's a John. John Shaft. I said that both parts of his name, what they evoke. Let's see. He has several times where he talks about the dirtiness of John Shaft's floor. And see, I think he said in the first book, he said he should maybe get one of his females to clean the apartment to work out some sort of deal. He says his floor was so dirty that a Hindu firewalker probably wouldn't go across the floor in his bare feet. Now, I mean, the metaphors, I just pay attention. Hindu firewalker, that's a non-white person as well, I suspect. All of the detail as well on the contrast of John Shaft's blackness and this white woman, the paleness of her skin, and her hair is gold, not just blonde, but golden. Let's see. Shaft's paint focus again. So we had a cocky black child, and then Shaft's royal readiness. Doesn't get any better than tacky. Let's see. So I just said I have no idea what a Tennessee bathroom, what that reference was. I don't know what that means. Maybe I'm not old enough, or maybe I haven't spent enough time in Tennessee. This one, so the white woman is talking to Shaft, and she says, "Mr. Shaft, did anyone ever tell you you are built like a brick shithouse?" I've never heard that phrase used to describe someone. It doesn't sound flattering. And again, associating black people with feces, very common system of white supremacy. Let's see. This whole pornographic scene, it's described where she has him get on his knees and he writes that Shaft is kneeling at the altar. Like, are you serious? Like, again, now, if I was even familiar with any of this, as the caller investor wrote in and said, it would dramatically change how I think about these films. If I had read the book and then I go watch the movie, or if I, you know, go see the movie and, oh man, Shad, I'm gonna get a turtleneck too, and Isaac Hayes, blah, blah, blah. Then I read this book like, whoa, whoa. At least I'm gonna have some serious questions, some serious things to think about. Maybe have to go watch this movie again real serious. Notepad in hand. Let's see.
Can I be heard?
Retired fire with us as well. Yes, sir.
Yes. The identification brick bathroom. Brick shit house actually for the most part was utilized as a compliment. Around the 70s up to the 80s, it's a lot less used now. I would say probably, you know, by young people your age and younger. And it serves from a masculine or a feminine standpoint. On the masculine side, it would be something in the terms of athletics, the violent type of athletics, super muscular shape, and that can also be feminine also. As far as the description is concerned, when it comes to the feminine side, it's a black female that is very voluptuous in shape. That term was used. You know, she looks like a brick shithouse, quote unquote. So I mean, it was somewhat popular. What I was going to say that the modern day version of Shaft is dramatically different from the 1970s version, and it's not that much of a surprise. It shouldn't be to anybody if they know on the people that was involved in the more modern day. All of them are notable for being less confused about the system of racism and white supremacy, including the person that played Shaft, Samuel Jackson, is a lot less confused. I put it this way. I don't know him or Mr. Roundtree personally, but I would say as far as what Mr. Jackson has displayed at his workplace called, actor, not in all his movies now, but in some of them, you have seen where he was a lot less confused. There is some real life instances that he was involved in when he was a young person. He was actually at the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King's funeral as a part as one of the ushers or something like that. But anyway, and also, you know, the legendary Mr. Singleton. And you as you would know, I'm assuming that you've seen all of those movies, is that in all of them, it was a constructive relationship between black males and black females in the movie, in all of those different movies. All of the females that the central characters had as from an affection standpoint were non-white black males and females in the movie, unlike, you know, the Shaft book, as well as an instance in the early Shaft movie with white women, that did not occur in none of the modern versions of Shaft at all. And like I said, it shouldn't be a surprise based on who the people that was involved with the effort. Yes, there were some of the criminals were non-white black people, but it had a political, attachment to it, based on what Mr. Singleton, I would guess, understanding of racism, white supremacy, and how he fashioned it into this action movie, so to speak. I noticed in some of the different scenes in the movie that occurred. In other words, if it was going to be a black quote unquote criminal, it was going to be someone who, then again, it goes back to Mr. Fuller's understanding monsters and monstrosities. A non-white black person who, with their reaction to racism, white supremacy, just becomes a predator to other black people. And then here is Mr. Jackson playing Shaft. He comes and saves the day. As you recall, in the movie, a mother actually approached him on how some black males were influencing her son, influencing her son to be a part of the gang, and that was a deal that she wanted him to do for her to, you know, kind of like take care of that. And he went down the corner and beat up the leader of the group and terrorized the other guys in the gang and basically got her son out of that situation. You know, something that is politically relevant to what's going on today in a lot of places where non-white people are forced to stay in such environments. But yeah, that's the difference between the early versions. What I noticed anyway, the early versions and the modern day versions, is it has more of a less confused political tag to it. And that's all I say. Thank you.
Much obliged, retired firefighter in Florida. Let's see. I'll share a thought on some of the other more recent Shaft creations. I'll double check *61* if folks have any concluding thoughts or questions about the Shaft book that we are finishing up that they want to get in before we wrap up. I don't know what that was, like a chapter or two chapters or what, but I took quite a few notes on the last little snippet from Shaft Among the Jews. So I'll get those in and then I'll get a word in on the movie, see if anyone else has commentary, and we'll call it a broadcast. Let's see. There's so much. Like, he has this whole sentence where Tidyman is talking about John Shaft's penis. Black, white, genetic annihilation. Dr. Welsing talked about all of this. His cock, his jollop, his meat, his licorice stick. Like, come on. all of this attention from a white man? Licorice stick? Now that's delectable Negro. Again, black person as candy. Again. Let's see. He says that this whole sexual encounter, and he's explaining, how did I end up with this crazy office design and everything that, you know, I don't like, and it's all these crazy colors and such. And he says, oh, this white woman. Why had he ever brought her up to the office in the first place? Question. Because his awareness answered truthfully, she was in charge and had been right from the first. Super important. We talk about that all the time in terms of who's in charge. Who is this book written for again? Very important. Those power dynamics, which is something that I don't think is present when they have all of this sexual fantasy in a lot of these movies that came out, these blaxploitation films. That bit of truth is generally not present in terms of the white person always being more powerful in these tragic situations. Let's see. They have Shav talking about having no family or friends. He says specifically the only family he, Shav, ever had was the welfare department, and they hadn't been in communication since the judge had let him join the army and go to NAM instead of the street hoodlums' postgraduate classes behind bars. And that was a long time ago. Now, again, none of that. They don't really spend any time on that. They spend way more time talking about sex and black penises and all the rest of it, as opposed to, oh, yeah, this is happening in the backdrop of Vietnam, which is impacting tens of thousands of black people in this part of the world alone, or the foster care system, which continues throwaway children. There's not really any serious attention to that. That's just kind of, you know. Oh, yeah, brief snippet. So you get a little background and then back to sex, 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 penis, penis, all this. Let's see. Now, again, a white man is writing this. So he has a moment where Shaft, he's contemplating, am I going to check the mail or do this or whatever the case? And he says, nah, forget that. The only family. Oh, wait a minute. It's the same one. He says, thinking momentarily about the lifeguard on the beach at Montego Bay, Jamaica, the big, muscular, black man, bigger by 30 pounds than Shaft, had said that Americans didn't know how to roll a joint, proceeding to take out a ditty bag of native ganja, roll a big fat one, and blow it right there in the Caribbean sunshine. Now, again, all of this focused back on these big, muscular black male bodies from a white author, and then we go from that to another phallic symbol, smoking. Dr. Welsing has a whole chapter in the ISIS papers on that, cigarettes and cigars and all of that, and oh, you all don't know how to roll, so I'm going to roll this big fat joint, all of that. Dr. Welsing breaks down the symbolism of all of that, the obsession with smoking, a white man doing all everything. We got so much focus on this, we could have spent more time on Vietnam, foster care, how that impacted him. That's not what we want. That's why I said, in turn, who is this, you know, intended for? Ernest Tidyman co-wrote the first two screenplays, that Vietnam information not getting there. He can say that he complained about it not being there. He may have been lying. He may have had a hand. And yes, no even need to bring that up. I didn't even talk about it and go into it in that much detail in the book. I was just about a sex machine. Might as well keep the focus there. Let's see. He says Shaft assumed that they were Jewish simply because they appear to be Jewish. Like, whoa, what does that even mean? I thought he said that they were wearing cowboy hats Is that so-called typical Jewish attire? I've never heard that before. let's see. He says when he's explaining, like, I go out and do investigate cases where the police maybe won't. And he says that he can get into a lot of things where nobody would expect a black man to be, which made it easier for him to operate and gather information quietly without raising the barriers of suspicion, which was very pleasing. And he thought he felt a breeze raised up and down. Now, I heard that. And I mean, some of that is in The Spook Who Sat by the Door book and movie that came out at the same time period, the late Sam Greenlee. I'm of the opinion that that is not true. In a system of white supremacy, like if you have a broom, maybe you can go hither and yonder. But I mean, they got a court case right here in Tacoma, Washington. Black male was out delivering papers and was nearly killed. It's lots of cases like that. So, and particularly a black person being someplace where you're not supposed to be or where black people normally aren't. In my experience, generally that draws an extraordinary amount of suspicion, attention, 911 calls. Like, it is not easy to just hang out and, oh, I can just be here, especially a large black male. I can just be hanging out and making notes, gathering information, and nobody's paying attention to you or questioning what you're doing. That's not my experience at all. Not even close. Let's see. Schwartz. So they leave, they go, they're speaking Yiddish to kind of discuss if they're going to hire Shaft or not. And he doesn't understand them, but they keep saying Schwartze, and he doesn't know what that means. We talked about that before. Even that these white individuals who I suspect are white, even though here they're supposed to be so-called Jewish, are sitting here talking about, oh man, are we going to hire this Negro? What do you think? Are we going to hire this Negro? I don't know. He is a Negro. Schwartze. Dr. Welsing, she talks about that too. She went to Germany after she graduated med school to have this whole dialogue, and he doesn't even know what's happening. Like, what's happening? Marvin Gaye, 50 years, same time period. We don't understand what's happening. They're sitting here talking about racism, white supremacy, flagrantly right in his face, and he doesn't understand. And as opposed to having Shaft think like, what are they saying? Maybe I should try and write down some of this so I can figure it out. I can go to the library and get some of this information afterwards. No. They have him. His response is, man, they're in here wasting all this time. He thought about dinner, drinks, get some alcohol, unpacking his bags, taking a shower, getting laid, trying a taste of the Jamaican boo. Now, that's another one. I don't know what that means. Maybe that's what they were calling ganja back in the day. And that's another, like, I want to see, I've studied the Negro. See, I know all their slang. White man, right? Had I known that this was written by a white man, I would have had a very different thought process about Shaft. Like, it would have been, oh yeah, we're going to go and study, but this is not some, oh, we're rooting for Shaft, and I'm going to get a black leather jacket too, and oh, let's all get an act like, eh. We're going to do some serious study. What does the white man think and know about the Negro? Let's see. Jamaican. I've never even heard that before. Jamaican boo. I've been to Jamaica. I've been to Montego Bay specifically. I don't remember anybody there talking about Jamaican boo. Let's see. Just reminded me of Mr. Fuller when he said the so-called Jews, when they wanted to hire Shaft, they said that we want you to check out everything from the movement of the smallest speck of dust to the cutting of the largest stone that is not done today as it was yesterday, as it was the day after that. Now, I mean, that sounds like racist man, racist woman that we've heard before. Bottom of the ocean, one grain of sand. So he gets his fee. He says his fee, if he did everything he was supposed to do, would come to something just over $574,000. Now, that's another one. I just don't use language like that in describing money. It would be like, whoa, oh my God, $574,000. Like, you know, you could, like, and again, sex machine. so much shaft. So much of this just goes back area two, sexual intercourse, sexual intercourse. That's the only way that this, that's all he's thinking about is having sex. That's his whole name, John Shaft. How can I get her to bed quickly to bed? You're all wasting my time. I could be getting late. That's all I'm thinking about. Black male penis, getting late. Even the child, cocky. So he's supposed to get $500,000. And it's immediately, even that, he says he went into a state of financial shock that lasted maybe a second before his imagination began spending it. I thought that was so important because that's how they think about us, black people. Oh, yeah, that's the nigger. Nigger rich, they call it. Give it to him, he'll go out and have 50,000 leather jackets and, you know, run up a bar tab and get some fancy cars and some other goofiness. Like, that's how they think about us, you know. They're not, we give it to them, they'll give it back to us immediately. Have it back by the end of the week. They're not intelligent. They're not smart. He'll go and have sex with 50,000 white women and be broke by the end of the year. Let's see. Many, like I said, took lots of notes on that one little snippet of Shaft among the Jews. I guess all I'll say quickly about the other, the later versions of this movie. I don't know if people saw the film Inception, but where they talk about a concept or an idea that sometimes or frequently that original concept or idea, it may mutate, it may change a little bit, but it'll just be a different variation of that same concept. That is very common in the system of white supremacy. With the 2000 version from the late John Singleton, who apparently read the ISIS papers and tried to weave some of her theory into Baby Boy, another one of his movies, that the Shaft movie from 2000 starts with graphic sexual intercourse. Now, it's between a black male and a black female, if that makes anybody feel better. And it's got Isaac Hayes Shaft playing in the background. So, I mean, sex machine. That is through and through what this whole series, book, all of that is about. Black male, I'd say specifically, but black people are just super extra hyper sexualized. And that continues. I think that's the line that I think people know from that movie. That was a part of the trailer. Shaft saying, it's my duty to please that booty. Sex machine, black people being hyper sexualized again. Now, there are some, you know, politics, one could say. Same thing, like one could say in this, in all of it, really. Racial theater, you might say, where there's some element where racism comes up. There's a black male character who is killed by a white man in Shaft. That's the main kind of plot that they're trying to solve. This white man has killed this black guy, and why did he do it? And he's going to get away with it. And Shaft is upset about all of this and, you know, is trying to correct this wrong. But this is a tragic arrangement. Not exact. In fact, I think that might be the most affection that you see other than Shaft. And it's my duty to please that. But if that, you know, counts as affection for you, I guess the standard presentation between black males and black females, that, I guess, is an improvement to some degree. But I mean, it's still just, you know, something tacky. Shaft isn't married. He doesn't have a wife or anything of that nature. Anywho. And Richard Roundtree is even in that one, and he's with multiple females. John Shaft, one of them looks like she could be white. Again, he's not married. He's much older at this point, not married, doesn't have grandchildren, that sort of thing. Right in line with the whole concept. Anyway, this white man kills a black guy, and they spend most of the rest of the film trying to correct all of that. I don't know if I'd say there's, you know, affectionate moments between black males and black females in the film. I think there's a scene with Shaft where you mentioned where this mom asks for help. And this is another, like a pickup line. This is not a, well, let's, you know, the whole family go to the park and sit down, talk about the neighborhood and the history of New York. Did you know my uncle was, that's not what it is. You're free on what night? My duty to please that booty. And then he goes, and the word that retired firefighter used, terrorize, and that's exactly what it is. Shaft is not a police officer. He goes and literally beats this black guy, pistol whips him, exactly what we heard in the book, pistol whips him, broad daylight, middle of the street. You're not a police officer. This is assault with a deadly weapon. He should have went to jail. The police watch this and do nothing. Like, I was stunned, like, oh my gosh, like flagrant anti-blackness. Like, why is this allowed? You could just go beat pistol whip a black male in broad daylight. The police watch this and do nothing. If he's a criminal, arrest him. No, we'll just have some hood vigilantism where Shav can beat down this black male bloody. And then he pulls out his gun on the other black people around like, oh, my God, the exact word, terrorize. He doesn't do that to the white man who has killed this black guy. The white man calls his dad, gets his attorneys. He's out skiing and sweat. That's the whole movie. This white man can't do that to him. I'm a powerful white man. And it takes a white woman in all of this, the person who is the hero who they need to get this white man, is a white woman. So there's some different element. I think Vanessa Williams is even in Beauty, American Beauty Pageant, Vanessa Williams. I think there's some elements of that film that, you know, are, I guess, attempting to be constructive. Again, within the constraints. John Singleton, Gordon Parks, everybody. Under the constraints of white supremacy, racism in the area of entertainment, you try to do the best that you can. I think that was the same thing you said about Baby Boy. They read Dr. Welsing's work at the beginning and then, yeah. You do the best you can under the constraints. But I mean, this felt like it would be really difficult to take this book and flip it and make it constructive. Like you would almost have to start from scratch and do something else as opposed to, that would be another one. I would be curious if John Singleton read these books. Ernest Tidyman's name flashes on the screen at the beginning of the Singleton Shaft creation. I don't know if he read those books, like, oof, especially if he read these books, Ernest Tidyman's work, after he read Dr. Welsing, like, man, black self-respect, no thanks, let's make something else. I'm intelligent, I've made amazing films, I've made Rosewood, I could do Black Wall Street, or so many different stories that could be told, documentaries, or, you know, if you want to dramatize an event that actually happened, Harold Washington's campaign for mayor in Chicago, Shirley Chisholm's run for president, and so many different things that could have been dramatized. Like, I would have appreciated that way more than another Shaft. Yeah, I would say something about the most recent version, but I haven't seen that one. But like I said, would they say that the fruit doesn't fall far from the tree? It would be, if it's all working from this same project, it would be very difficult to land someplace, I'd say constructive and leave it at that, but it would be very difficult to land substantially far away from a lot of the original concepts, anti-blackness, homoeroticism, the name Shaft, all that sexual content. I remember some of the film promos that I saw for the later Shafts. It was still, even beyond just Shaft, it was the lines that they were saying, like, bigger, round. I have to go back and get some of the movie bills, but it was tied right back into black male penis, black male penis, black male penis. A lot of people can say that's tongue-in-cheek and, you know, great sex sells and people like that and all that. But, I mean, woof, from the origins of this white man, Ernest Tidyman, and all of that, and then what I see in the films, like, Anywho, that's my view, my thoughts on the book, the film. You see the same threads running through all of the content for the most. Maybe I'll watch the most recent one to see if that's true. Do you see the same threads in all of the work, even the 2019? But at least out of what I've seen and read thus far, oh, yeah. Tidyman's mind is in the gutter. And, yeah, you start in the gutter, it's hard to get out. Anywho, any folks, any other comments they need to get in? Said we're supposed to be done a little bit early today because we finished the book. Bravo. Anything else they need to get in? Grand, grand. I am not sure what book we'll read next. I thought we could do Elizabeth Holmes' book. That's the white woman who's currently on trial in California for allegedly duping Safeway and all these major investors out of, like, millions, could have been billions of dollars. She could face like up to 20 years in prison. My thought process was, hey, if people really want to read that book, we could read that book now, because I said this book is so short, we'll finish Shaft and that trial will still be going on. All of that proved to be true. My only concern is this is allegedly a very high profile trial. Elizabeth Holmes, if people have been following this, no one has sent me like any reports. People send me information and news clips about lots of things every day. Untiljustice@gmail.com. My email, they post on social media and everything. I include the information in our compensatory call in and all that. This trial has been going on for close to 2 months. Not one person has sent me a report. Like, no one's mentioned it on the compensatory call in. So I kind of have the impression that people are not like glued to the, you don't have to watch it. I don't think it's on TV, but I mean, you could easily be following this trial like every day for the people, if they were excited and wanted to read the book on Elizabeth Holmes, which I think is called Bad Blood. I know that's what it's called. I have it. It's Bad Blood, written by a white man with the Wall Street Journal. But yeah, like I said, I haven't got the impression that a lot of Cows listeners are really paying attention to this case and know the deal. I've seen people where they saw reports about it before the trial started, and or they were listening to different podcasts about it. But I mean, you could just get the paper. You could get the paper today and see what happened in the trial. I think the prosecution is still laying out their case, although they might be getting to the end, and then the defense will pick up and be doing their part. But that's one option. Countdown is a different book written by two white women, I believe, and is about the concern about rising rates of infertility amongst males in particular, white men in particular. That right in line with Dr. Welsing's theory. Very popular book. Thought that we could read that one. There are a few other options as well, but yeah, we'll have to think about that between now and next week. Either way, next Thursday, new book. We'll be here tomorrow, Neutralizing Workplace Racism, same time, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. We will hopefully, man, whew, it just continues. I think President Biden, new mandate is supposed to go in effect sometime within, I think, the next, like, think by the beginning of the year, that for large corporations, businesses, if you have over 100 employees, mandatory, employees have to be vaccinated or tested. And I think for a substantial number of folks, there's no test option. You have to be vaccinated or you are out of there. So, man, we will continue, I guess, to try to make sense of what's happening in the workplace and do the best we can tomorrow. And then compensatory call in on Saturday, 9 p.m. Eastern, 6 p.m. Pacific. We'll review what's been going on the past week, first week of November. Incidentally, since this is the book club, from way back when, we read Rebecca Skloot's The Immortal Life of Henrietta Lacks way back in 2014, right? It's been 7 years. I think some of the folks that are here, a retired firefighter might have been here, some of the other folks. I groused about that book. I don't think it was on the worst book ever list, but I said, man, talk about anti-blackness in the book we just read. Like, oh my gosh. I said, there's no way you could read this book and have a constructive, positive opinion of black people. You would think they're all just idiots and stupid and angry and uneducated and uncouth and all the rest of it. There's no way you would have a positive opinion of black people. This is what happens when white people write a book. Lots to say because it's a lengthy book. We spent a lot of time on it in the archives, 2014. Her grandson, Ron Lacks, finally got his book published talking about the racism, medical apartheid that his grandmother experienced. Oh my God, he's coming on the program. It should be next week. You can get his book, read it in advance. It's so many components of racism. One that I'll just mention now. He's been going out. He was on Democracy Now, I think, last month, and doing other programs to promote his book. And the family has a lawsuit about, you know, what was done to their mom, his grandmother. So his publicist, who's a black female, I was talking to her and trying to help get all this arranged. She said when Mr. Lacks goes out, does his interview, speaks to Democracy Now, my BFF Amy Goodman and all the rest, Rebecca Skloot's book scales skyrocket, not Ron Lacks. That's one element of white supremacy racism. The other quick one I'll give you as we wrap up. Mr. Lax directly, like when I spoke to him, he said, my book was doing so well. It was so important to me to talk about what happened to my grandmother and blah, blah, blah. And the Oprah Winfrey film. Remember we talked about that. The Oprah Winfrey movie. I didn't even watch that. Like, you can do that for homework. If you don't want to go back and read Rebecca Skloot's book or listen to the archives of the book club, watch the Oprah Winfrey movie on the, because we talked about that. That movie had not been released when we read The Immortal Life. It was coming out, but we talked about that in between. And oh my gosh, and this is going to be horrible if it's based on this book and blah, 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 and all the rest of it. So watch that movie. Anyway, and Mr. Lax talks about that in his book. Anyway, he says, so my wife and I, black female, we look on Amazon and our book is selling well. And I think he said, you know, it was like it had reached like the top 1,000 book sales on Amazon. Now, I might be incorrect about the exact number. I'll verify when he speaks with us next week. But I think he said it was like the top 1,000, right? So they were really proud, took a screenshot, like, oh man, the book is selling, people are finding out, blah, 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 and all this. All of a sudden, book goes out of stock. Now, they do have the Kindle edition, so you can get that. That's what I got. But if you want like the hard copy, right, people do have libraries and books. I do as well. Out of stock. And he said that's bizarre, or at least curious, because it is an on-demand publishing, on-demand printing, right? So they aren't just, you know, stockpiling books. They just see as the orders come in and boom, they get them printed off, boom, boom, boom. It's not, you know, a gargantuan 1,000-page book. So boom, 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 what's the holdup? Out of print. And then to compound, I went and looked today, right? Because I had shared this with people before. Told them what he said. He gave alternate links where people can go and get the book. I shared them online repeatedly. We'll continue to do so until next week when he comes on the program. I went back and looked at Amazon just to see, like, maybe they got their act together and, you know, you can get the hard copy book and everything is back up. Nope. In fact, it's the same thing that I have seen with Neely Fuller Jr.'s work, Dr. Francis Cress Welsing's work, even Anthony Pryor. Folks remember him? He was a former football player, and he wrote several books on racism and the NFL. I think it's called The Slave Side of Sunday. I think that's the name of his book. But anyway, Mr. Pryor, he has multiple books. All of these authors, black people, had books on Amazon. Their books were priced something legitimate, $20, $25, $30, some of them even cheaper than that. Mr. Ron Lack's book, Henrietta Lacks, The Untold Story, the hard copy was $300. And I've seen that exact sort of price gouging for black books, books written by someone classified as black. I've seen this for years, the whole time that the cows has been on, especially at Amazon, but I've seen it at other sites as well. It doesn't matter if it's a new book, an older book, still in print, whatever. They will do things like that. Sometimes people will even go and buy up all of the books. That's what they would do in Mr. Pryor's book. He said that he would do like sales. He would show up. They'd have a convention, let's say like Texas or Washington State. They would come. He'd have like 50 books, sell them all, boom, boom, boom. And then the people would take those books. Somebody would come and buy like 20 of them and then go back and sell them online for $300 or $400 or $500. Many different levels of white supremacy racism. Reading is more important than watching television. We'll be here tomorrow. Sobriety would be best under conditions of white supremacy. They had Shav drinking a lot of alcohol, movie and the book. Sobriety would be best. If you're going out, I would be safe. I'd be alert, paying attention. If people are being rowdy and violent around you, exit. This is not a time. This is not a time to be in random verbal confrontations with strangers, in my opinion. Exit. If you didn't leave your residence prepared to kill and or die, get out of there. I think evacuate is the other E word. If you're driving, you are buckled, not on the phone, and you are sober, as I just said, doing all the small things that we can to minimize contact with race soldiers, badge or no. Kyle Rittenhouse. That said, Creator, we ask that you help us remain patient. with other black people, victims of white supremacy. We ask that you help us remain patient with ourselves. Remind us to demonstrate the highest levels of black self-respect at all times, in all places, each and every time we are in contact with another black person. It has been time. Replace white supremacy with justice immediately. Cow signing out. Thanks all for tuning in.
Nigga, you so brainwashed.
I'm a victim,
your
brother.
Problem. A victim.
I'm a victim of 400 years of conditioning.
Shut up.
The man has programmed my condition. Mm-hmm. Even my conditioning has been conditioned.